Morning, glory, America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt on the West Coast this morning, but saluting the 70th anniversary of the accession to the throne of Queen Elizabeth II that happened on Sunday. I mean, my hat is off to anyone who can do anything for 70 years. And not only do it, but endure the ups and downs of it. From working on motor vehicle things during the Blitz, through the sudden death of her father when she's in Kenya, through the entire 70 years that have followed Queen Elizabeth, has always put duty ahead of everything else. She's a God, country, and Commonwealth person, and I admire that. Now, there have been times when people have disagreed with her and they feel estranged, they've caught up in the Queen, et cetera, and the whole Princess Diana affair. But you do something for 70 years with that kind of aplomb, and we will applaud you too. So my hat is off to Queen Elizabeth this morning. And whether or not you know it, and you probably don't, the Olympics are underway. Or they're not. The Olympics opening ceremony drew record low television ratings. Why aren't Americans tuning in? Asked Dan Wetzel, columnist at Yahoo. The reason is the Americans hate the Chinese Communist Party. And the American people want nothing to do with these Olympics, and they don't. They're going to punish the sponsors. I absolutely think they're going to punish the sponsors. I did not follow the whole. I like Savannah Guthrie. She's always been nice to me. I worked 2016 election night with Savannah back when NBC did it that way, and meaning that they had political analysts who were pro-Trump and political analysts who were anti-Trump instead of just anti-Trump. But I got to know Savannah a little bit, very professional. I don't know what she said about China, what went viral, what got taken down. I don't know what anyone said on NBC about this because I haven't watched it. I'm not going to watch a minute of this genocidal maniac regime's propaganda pageant. All power to the athletes. I will congratulate them upon their return. I won't know who they are because I didn't know who they are before they went off. I don't follow winter sports, and I'm not watching it, and I'm going to. I hope you're not watching it. I'd like a list of the sponsors because I want to know who not to participate in. By the way, there is a story in the Wall Street Journal over the weekend. As China gained clout, Hollywood looked for a new villain, a deep dive into the 2008 Red Dawn remake, which was originally going to feature China as the villain. Couldn't be Russia anymore. Russia was, it couldn't be the Soviet Union was gone. So they wrote the whole thing. They started, Tom Cruise is in it. They're making all their Wolverine shots. And then they figure out, oops, we've got to kill this movie or China's going to kill us. And they did. That's when it began, 2008. 14 years later, one NBA player will say something bad about China and no movie will say anything bad about China. But the American people know that China poisoned the world and they have concentration camps. So we're not going to the 1936 Olympics 2.0. Not doing it, not watching it. People in Tennessee aren't watching it because they haven't got any power. My thoughts are with you if you're running one of your battery-powered radios. Tens of thousands in Memphis, still in the dark after winter. It was a rough weekend. I personally went to Phoenix on Friday and moderated with Kathy Herrod of Cap Action two debates on Saturday morning at 8:30 to noon. Debate number one. Four of five candidates for the Arizona Republican Party's nomination for Senate. The primary is in August. Again, it's February. We had 750 people there. They had to pay $10 a ticket to keep the lunatics from breaking the website. It wasn't supposed to make any money for Cap Action, who invited me to moderate it along with their president, Kathy Herrod. But it was quite a demand signal, 750 people. And very, very interesting. I'll be talking in the second hour with Governor Christie about that. Very, very interesting. Fascinating where the Republican Party in Arizona is, what its candidates believe, who is leading, and what will happen. I'll tell you about it as the show goes on, but I did have a great time. But I got into Phoenix on Friday. I wanted to come back to California on Saturday because I was having lunch Sunday with the Fetching Mrs. Hewitt and two of our dearest friends in the world, our old pastor and his spouse. And they were preaching at Laguna Presbyterian Church. We drove down on Sunday and heard them and had lunch with them yesterday. And just Mark Roberts gave a great sermon. And the Third Project at the Dupree Center at Fuller is an amazing project that Mark is the senior strategist for, and he writes a daily devotional. And we're talking about, he's just a brilliant scholar and teacher. And you've heard him on this show many, many times. In fact, he lives forever on this show, as long as this show does, because he does the Christmas Eve show every year in taped form. And he came on and debated Christopher Hitchens on this show. If you're a longtime listener to the Hugh Hewitt Show, you know who Mark Roberts is. So I had to get back. So I ran to the airport as soon as the debate was over, after I'd been booed. It's the second time I've been booed as a debate moderator. All right? Second time. First time was when I asked Ben Carson an inartful question about, could he really drop a nuclear bomb on anyone? Because Ben Carson's the nicest man ever, and people who like Ben Carson booed me. It was actually a compliment. But that's okay. It's part of the job. This is the business we have chosen, right, from The Godfather. So I quoted President Trump to them in the course of the governor candidate, of course, talking about vaccines and boosters. And in so doing, I referenced, they did not have audio. I just had read it and listened to it. This exchange between President Trump and Bill O'Reilly, cut number 10.
But look, we did something that was historic. We saved tens of millions of lives worldwide. We, together, all of us, not me, we. We got a vaccine done, three vaccines done, and tremendous therapeutics like Regeneron and other things that have saved a lot of lives. We got a vaccine done in less than 9 months that was supposed to take from 5 to 12 years. Because of that vaccine, millions and millions of people, I think this would have been the Spanish flu of 1917, where up to 100 million people died. This was going to ravage the country far beyond what it is right now. Take credit for it. It's a great, what we've done is historic. Don't let them take it away. Don't take it away from ourselves. You're playing right into their hands when you sort of like, oh, the vaccine. If you don't want to take it, you shouldn't be forced to take it. No mandates, but take credit, because we saved tens of millions of lives. Take credit. Don't let them take that away from you.
Okay, so the president made news.
Do you agree with that? Right?
Both the president and I are vaxxed, and did you get the booster?
Yes.
I got it, too. Okay, so...
Don't. That's all. There's a very tiny group of it.
Very tiny group over there. He went on to say, we got to get the rest of the clip, Dwayne. Don't do that. Booster's out there. I can't remember exactly what he said, but he's a boosted president, and he said later, I don't understand why people don't tell you whether they're boosted. Can you go and see if that's around, Dwayne? And so I referenced this in a question to the Arizona would-be governors, saying, do you applaud the vaccinations, and have you been boosted? And I got booed by about the same number of people who booed Trump. There were maybe 10 people, very anti-booster. One of them, nice guy, comes up and said, you're lying about the president. He didn't say that. And I said, no, I actually prepare for this stuff. I'm not lying. President said, get the booster. That's what he said. And you just and get the vaccine and take credit for it. I do not understand that quadrant. There are two kinds of people. They're either pro-Trump and anti-Trump, and then they're either pro-vaccine or anti-vaccine. I do not understand that quadrant that are pro-Trump and anti-vax. I don't get it. Now I'm vaccinated, I have a booster, and I think the science is clear, and I hope you go out and get it today. You've heard me say that. I'm not going to change anyone's mind now. That's not going to happen. So I don't talk about it very much, but that's what I believe, and it's out there to be used and saves lives. And I don't want to get sick. And if they have another shot, I'll take another shot. I learned over last week that vitamin D matters, so I made sure I upped my vitamin D intake. I'm no dummy. I'm 65. I want to go to A.T. Roll, 101 on his own wheels in his own house. That's the Ashtabula line. All right, so if you can make it to the Ashtabula line. A lot of you are moving to Florida and Texas because you're not tough. And that's okay. Not all of us were born to be Buckeyes. I was sitting on the patio with Refreshing Mrs. Hewitt and the Roberts yesterday having lunch at a great restaurant in Laguna Beach. And a guy spotted my Guardians hat, which is very, 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 if you can see it over my shoulder, if you're watching on the Salem News Channel, the Guardians gear is, you know, you have to be ahead of the curve to get the Guardians gear. And the guy said, Guardians, go Guardians. I said, go Guardians. And they said, OH. And I said, IO. And Fetching Mrs. Hewitt and the Roberts look at me like I was from Mars. Honestly, I don't understand, but if you're Ohio tough, you don't You don't get deterred by people booing you. You talk about it. We come back. Ukraine on the brink. Chris Christie's coming up today. We'll make some news on that. Do not miss that. We're going to follow up on his ABC News This Week appearance yesterday. But we are also going to, if I tell you something in a debate, you can take it to the bank. That's what I want to tell my friends in Arizona who were booing me yesterday, Saturday. I'll be right back, America. It's the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Birch Gold Group.
Both the president and I are vaxxed, and both the president and I are vaxxed, and did you get the booster?
Yes.
I got it, too. Okay, so...
Don't. That's all right. There's a very tiny group over there.
This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with a clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with two senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, two former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet, with 3 years to go, is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
The Supreme Court has said is you have to have a compelling state interest, and the compelling state interest that the Supreme Court found was the benefits that flow from having a diverse student body, whatever those benefits may be. But you have to have a diverse student body to get these certain benefits, okay? So that justifies this kind of racial alchemy in terms of admissions. Here's the problem. Increasingly at schools, you have, regardless of how supposedly integrated they are, you're getting more and more racial separatism, separate classes, separate dormitories, separate graduations. There's more and more of that going on. And one of the basic reasons for that is because of mismatch, because of the serious mismatch in academic qualifications between Asians, Latinos, blacks, and whites.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
You want to know what's even crazier and funnier in a sick way? There's a security guard right there. The shoplifter, the looter, walks right by the security guard who isn't doing anything. He's got a jacket on with a big security on the back of his coat, and he stands there and watches the guy. The guy literally brushes right by the security guard. The security guard, what are they paying the security guard for? Just to stand there? Why don't we just put mannequins up in stores in New York? I may never go back. I swear, I may never go back. New York is turning into a hellhole. And Democrats are watching it. They're letting it happen. I can't wait to get Joe Borelli's take on all of this insanity.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
You called your son. You personally promised him you would be here.
Lucas, I don't know how to help you.
Your daddy loves you. You gotta know it, pal. Do you feel
the love? Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work, if you believe.
What reason does he have to care about some guy who's supposed to be his dad, but he's never around?
I can't do it again. I'm not ready for this, man.
I'm done with you.
We all deserve a second chance, right, Ethan?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt from the West Coast today. I hope you folks are warming up. Some of you in Tennessee still don't have power 2 weeks in a row. I started to tell you, trying to get out of Phoenix, it was zombie apocalypse time at Phoenix Air Harbor. Is it Sky Harbor, they call the airport, on Saturday afternoon. Flight was scheduled for 2:30 or something like that. Canceled. American Airlines canceled it, moved it. At which time I went over and got on a Southwest plane, because Southwest, feel free to move around the country. It's not my favorite airline, because of, the endless chatter from the people running the plane. I'm kind of trying to read or something, and they always trying to tell jokes, et cetera. It's a Southwest shtick. I get it, but I'm grateful that they were running from Phoenix to California, because if you were trying to go from Phoenix east, you were screwed. There were lines of hundreds of people, and at which I posted a little note on Twitter that I was seeing a lot of the Phoenix airport because of the breakdown of the air, of the weather. Now, the weather broke down the flights. It happens. Nobody's fault. And one Phoenix wag said, most people like you just stay until April. And I get that, but I was trying to get back. Now, I got to tell you, the biggest takeaway of the weekend, thing you need to know, is that, as I told you, Mark Roberts was preaching at Laguna Presbyterian Church yesterday, and the two big reveals is a secular and a sectarian one. First big reveal on the secular one. On the drive down to Orange County to Laguna Beach, you have to go on the 73 and exit the 73 onto Laguna Canyon Road and head to the beach. It's a narrow road, and traffic backs up on every beautiful weekend day, and yesterday was a beautiful weekend day. And Laguna Beach has a sign, an electronic sign on Laguna Canyon Road. And I tweeted it out because we were stopped in traffic so I could film it. And I'm kind of amazed that a few hundred people thought it funny enough to retweet. I just put the not free state of California. And it's now had 241 people have retweeted, 513 people liked it, and 119 people have commented on most of them favorably, which is an unusual mix. It says, I want to read it to you as come up. The video begins just very, Laguna Beach is a smoke-free city. That's number one. Laguna Beach is a smoke-free city. It continues. Thank you for not smoking. Plastic utensils and straws are not allowed. At beaches and parks. Quiet zone ahead. Loud vehicles will be sighted. Laguna Beach. And that's it. That's their three message. Now, the speed limit on that road is 50 miles per hour. It was only because there was a traffic jam I was able to put up the audio. So that is the not free state of California. Welcome to the free state of Florida, the free state of Texas, and the not free state of California. I mean, that's just one little city. You can be homeless there and smoke dope, but do not smoke cigarettes. Don't take any plastic utensils to the beach. And if you have a loud car, Dwayne, you're going to be cited, buddy. So that was funny to me. But then Pastor Mark gave a great sermon. You look up Laguna Beach Presbyterian Church if you would like to listen to it on Peter. And he did the thing that great preachers do, made me understand gospel in a completely different way, wholly new, looking from the moment forward, not from our vantage backwards. And so he recommended to us a couple of what he does in the morning. Now, when I get up in the morning, I have to do the news. So I'm not doing devotionals when I get up. But when I get done, I have now got two new wonderful devotionals because of Mark and Linda. One is called, now, of course, I can't find them on my machine. One is called Lectio 365, Lectio, L-E-C, C as in Charlie, T-I-O, 365, and Pray As You Go. And they're both like the perfect, they're 8 to 10 to 12 minutes. I was trying to get Mark to start doing a third podcast or daily devotional. We'll see. When I come back, news of the day, poor Ukraine. They're depending on Joe Biden. How would you feel if you were them? Don't go anywhere. Andrew Cuomo's also making a comeback. We'll be right back.
The Hugh Hewitt Show is now available on TV. Go to SalemNewsChannel.com or download the app. You can also watch on Roku and Fire Stick. Salem News Channel, the antidote to the mainstream media.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
It seems like the Democrats tried their best to try to eliminate the filibuster, and it failed. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, thankfully, it did fail. Republicans stood united against that, as we have been from the very beginning, and Kyrsten Sinema and Joe Manchin also stood with us in preserving the rules and the customs of the Senate. These rules and customs go back more than 200 years, Charlie. They are directly downstream from why our founders created a Senate in the first place, to provide the sober second thought against radical sweeping change to our country. It's pretty amazing that 48 out of 50 Democrats were willing to blow up the filibuster. They were willing to break the rules to change the rules. And Charlie, that would have just been the first step towards redistributing political power in this country. The Democrats' next stop probably would have been to make Washington, D.C. a state, our federal city that is by far the most liberal jurisdiction in America. So the Democrats could get two more Democratic senators in perpetuity. The next stop would have been to pack our federal courts, to include the Supreme Court, to stop the courts from overturning any of these unconstitutional actions. This entire effort, Charlie, was not about just altering this or that public policy. It was about forever changing the structure of political power in our country. You sometimes heard the argument that, well, the Democrats shouldn't do this because the shoe was on their other foot. Their entire goal was to make sure, Charlie, the shoe would never be on the other foot. So it was a critical day in the history of our country and the history of the Senate as an institution. And I'm glad we stopped these radicals. That's why we have to turn them out of power in November.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
This really is a Leninist strategy. Lenin's old saying that the capitalists will sell us the rope by which we will hang them is what China's doing. The Soviets couldn't do it for a couple reasons. Number one, they didn't have the money. They didn't have a whole lot of rubles to throw around, and people in the West didn't want them. But number two, there was a lot bigger sense of social cohesion during the Cold War. The notion, if you're a corporate executive during the Cold War, that you would be playing footsies with the Kremlin was outrageous. And yet in the case of China, the human rights situation, the challenge to American national security is every bit as great. I would argue perhaps even greater than it was in the Cold War era. But Wall Street, Silicon Valley, they are all happy to not only do deals with them, but do deals with them that benefit the Chinese military and intelligence state, and they don't seem to particularly care that they do.
Well, there was stigma
in helping the Soviets. There's no stigma in helping the Chinese communists.
That's right. And I think that, you know, part of that is there's been this naivete for decades that if we just gave China money, if we gave them access to our technology, they were going to buy our blue jeans, they were going to watch some of our movies, they would become just like us. What's really happened, when you look at issues like censorship by big tech in the United States, when you look at some of the other things that are going on, it's not that China's become more like us. We've actually become more like China. And that experiment has to fade away. And the problem is, not only were our elites wrong in their prescription of that policy, but that policy made them rich. And they do not want to now give up those relationships with Beijing because it means the money is going to stop flowing.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming.
How a million children were placed with local foster families. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans.
Go to salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. It's Monday, and I hope you're ready for a great week. Monday's February the 7th in a year of our Lord 2022. Let me go back to the news. I told you the Olympic ceremony had record low television ratings. I haven't watched a minute. I hope you're not watching it. It's going to be a rebuke to every corporate sponsor of genocide and the suppression of Hong Kong and the destruction of Tibet and the attempted gagging of American athletes in television. The U.S.-led air bridge of weapons to Ukraine seeks to shore up Kyiv's ability to resist Russia. Now, I've said Kiev my entire life, and now they're saying Kyiv. And it's sort of like ISIL, ISIS, tomato, tomato. The trouble is not that we've got the weapons bridge going. It's that Germany is screwing with us, and they're sending their socialist prime minister to tell Joe Biden, if he can get his attention, that don't pay any attention to the Germany over here that is not participating in the defense of allies of NATO. Ukraine is not in NATO. It is an ally of NATO. It is deployed with NATO, taking bullets for us in Afghanistan and I believe Iraq as well. And the deliveries keep coming. The U.S. has sent 650 tons of armed equipment since the beginning of this year. Donald Trump sent lethal equipment. Joe Biden stopped it, slowed it down for a year. A large portion of the U.S. shipments to Kyiv have been taken up with ammunition in a variety of calibers. That's useful. Kurt Schlichter would be able to translate for you that, including high-intensity grenades. Now, that was the thing that got my attention in here. Dwayne is a high-intensity grenade, but I'm not sure. Dwayne, what do you think the difference is between a low-intensity grenade and a high-intensity grenade?
If it's next to you. Well, if you're standing right next to it, probably not a whole lot. If you're standing, you know, 30 feet away, probably more.
This is a Schlichter question. Remember, high-intensity grenade when he comes in the guest host for me next. My favorite part of this article is that, you know, it's all about Joe Biden responding, Joe Biden responding, Joe Biden responding, and Poland supplying Ukraine and Germany stopping, etc. And deep, deep, deep down in the article is that the authorizations still haven't been signed for some of the weaponry that is needed. Biden said he would send it. He still hasn't signed the authorization. An unnamed bureaucrat says, we're going to get there. Don't worry, we'll get it there. You know, they're going to get authorized when they're speaking Russian in Kyiv. Now, they already speak. Some people speak Russian. All right, next completely astonishing headline. A new attitude toward the pandemic seems to be taking shape. But we've been here before. This is in the Washington Post. I love the Post. I work for the Post. Where have they been? The new attitude towards the pandemic is everywhere I have gone outside of the Beltway in the last 2.5 months. And I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere. If I had a producer, I could play Johnny Cash. Because I've been up to Ohio, man. I've been to Minnesota, man. I've been to Arizona, man, doing debates in large rooms. I've been Nixon Library, man. I've been California, man. I go everywhere, man. I didn't get to go to the Super Bowl or the playoffs because the refs cheated the Browns. But I've been everywhere, and that new attitude is everywhere. It's people. Yeah. And they're not wearing masks outside, anywhere. And their schools aren't masking kids. All these places. I've been everywhere. I was at Arizona, and I did these debates, and nobody had a mask on. The hotel doesn't know. The employees mask. We go to a great restaurant on Friday night, and the servers are masked, and I suppose that's because some members of the public want the servers to be masked, and I don't care if they're masked. I can point to the menu. But I mask up on the airplane, and as soon as I get out of the airport, I take it off, and everybody else does. The new attitude is, we're done. Call us when you have a credible spokesperson, not named Dr. Fauci, and not named Jeff Zients, and we'll talk. But I do want, for the record, for that guy who came up to me after the Arizona debate and said I was lying about the former president, here is the former president, cut number 12.
Both the president and I are vaxxed, and did you get the booster?
Yes.
I got it, too. Okay, so...
Don't. That's all. There's a very tiny group over there.
Now, play the next one after he goes... For that was O'Reilly. Then he goes to OAN Network.
Well, I've taken it. I've had the booster. Many politicians... I watched a couple of politicians be interviewed, and one of the questions was, did you get the booster? Because they had the vaccine. And they're answering it like, in other words, the answer is yes, but they don't want to say it. Because they're gutless. You got to say it. Whether you had it or not, say it. Right. But the fact is that I think the vaccine has saved tens of millions of people throughout the world. Okay. I have had absolutely no side effects. I've had it like other people have had it, nothing special. I've had it.
Now, I want you, Mr. MAGA hat, I'm going to play it again, just so you know, I'm not making this stuff up. When I do a debate, I am ready. I've done my work. So when I asked the Arizona candidates what they thought of the vaccines and had they received the booster, and Arizona candidates for governor, there were four, Steve and Kerry and Karen and Matt, none of them would answer my question. Did you have the booster? And I had in mind President Trump's admonition, answer the question. And this fellow comes up and yells at me. You know, I don't really care whether they had it. It's an interesting follow-up. Why not? Would you recommend it? These people want to lead the state of Arizona with its 50,000 employees. Actually, Matt Simon said 38,000, but I checked, and it's 50. It depends on which count. But in any event, I might have been wrong on 50,000, but I wasn't wrong about the president. No one would answer. Nobody would answer. I'm just kind of stunned by that. You got to answer questions. Yes, no question. They all said it's nobody's business. Actually, it's everybody's business. It tells us your attitude towards this great debate, which is in, and I'm not taking sides here. You know what I've decided, but when I'm doing debates, I'm in Switzerland, right? I don't have a favorite on the stage or I wouldn't do it. It's not ethical to have a favorite and do it. I can't do the Missouri Senate debate because Eric Greitens should not be your nominee. He'll lose. So I can't do that debate. I can do a Pennsylvania Senate debate. I can do a Georgia governor's debate. I did the Arizona Senate and Arizona governor's debate. I did the Ohio Senate debate, the Minnesota governor. I got no dogs in those fights. I will not do the Morgan Ortegas debate when she gets into the race in Tennessee because I am for Morgan Ortegas. So I won't clip anybody. That's just foolish, not professional. But if I say something, it's true. So, Mr. MAGA hat, go away. A couple of things got said yesterday on the weekend show. Chris Christie coming up next hour. Cut number one.
Well, look, Martha, I think that the actions the vice president took on January 6th spoke loudly, and I'm glad he's finally put words to it. I don't know why it took him so long, but I'm glad that he did. And let's face it. Let's call this what it is. January 6th was a riot that was incited by Donald Trump. In an effort to intimidate Mike Pence and the Congress into doing exactly what he said in his own words last week, overturn the election. Now, he's tried to do a cleanup on aisle one here and correcting that stuff, but it's not going to change. He actually told the truth by accident. He wanted the election to be overturned. Donald Trump didn't
respond. I'm going to follow up with Chris Christie about that. Here is former Vice President Pence on the weekend, cut number 11.
President Trump is wrong. I had no right to overturn the election. The presidency belongs to the American people and the American people alone. And frankly, there is no idea more un-American than the notion that any one person could choose the American president. Under the Constitution, I had no right to change the outcome of our election.
Now, there are two legal views, the right one and the wrong one. Mike Pence is right. I've told you that forever. The Electoral Count Act does not give him the authority to set it to ministerial deal. President Trump is wrong on that as a matter of law. But there are some legal scholars out there who disagree with me. There are few. The overwhelming majority of people agree that President Trump is wrong and Vice President Pence is correct. I asked the four Arizona Senate candidates, who's correct, Pence or Trump? Three said Trump, one said Pence. I'm just curious how this is going to play out because it's actually not close. But I can tell you that what I fault legacy media for is not running with the 2016 precedents that got people in the mind that you could screw around with slates of electors. In that case, it was, could a faithless elector vote for Clinton instead of Trump anyway? And Lawrence Tribe said yes, and Lawrence Lessing said yes. They're both Harvard Law School professors. And Eric Black, the lefty in Minnesota, said yes, they can eat. They're all wrong. When the states certify, and there's only one slate, and it's been certified, there is, that's it, done, and the electors are bound. We do not follow the old rules. And so I just always find it amusing that the left doesn't tell you who started the idea of post-election chicanery. Al Gore, followed by John Kerry, followed by Hillary Clinton. That's who. Conservative-led school board fires superintendent after allegations of private ultimatum teacher protest. Washington Post story, I do not understand. They held a election in Colorado wherein three new candidates ran, criticizing the superintendent and the mask policy and telegraphing they were going to fire the superintendent. So they fired the superintendent after they won the election handily in Douglas County. What is the problem here? That's what's going to happen. Lots of superintendents are going to get fired. Lots. Lots of school board members are going to lose. Lots. That is democracy, small d, acting at the very local level to return sanity to school districts about which parents are unhappy. This is not a right-wing plot. It's not the Oath Keepers go to school. No, it's not that. In scrutinizing Trump and his allies, January 6th panel adopts prosecution tactics. Nothing is less interesting to me than whatever the January 6th rump committee is doing. It's like a rump parliament. And it has no legitimacy because of the way Nancy Pelosi set it up, destroying the rights of the minority. And it's got nothing to do with the prosecution in the United States because the rights of the minority or the accused are protected. They are not. This is a witch hunt. This is a kangaroo court. And Marco Rubio said as much yesterday. Cut number two.
Well, anybody who committed crimes on January 6th should be prosecuted. If you entered the Capitol and you committed acts of violence and you were there to hurt people, you should be prosecuted, and they are being prosecuted. But the January 6th commission is not the place to do that. That's what prosecutors are supposed to do. This commission is a partisan scam. They're going after, the purpose of that commission is to try to embarrass and smear and harass as many
that's
Republicans
what you believe
as they can get their hands on.
Your two Republican colleagues are doing? Liz Cheney
well, I believe that's what commission is doing. Well, let me tell you, I know that's what that commission is doing because they're focused well beyond January 6th. There are people, for example, like an older member of the RNC whose husband just died, and she wasn't even in Washington on January 6th.
But that's not what the censure said.
She signed some papers. She wasn't even in Washington on January 6th. She can't afford to lawyer up, and she's being harassed.
You know, I like Margaret Brennan. I do. But the January 6th obsession among legacy media is destroying their ratings. Fox News Sunday, Martha MacCallum, who hosted it yesterday, joining me a little bit later, is going to crush these other shows. ReliefFactor.com. New York Times story made me think of Relief Factor. The pandemic has made many seniors less active, which is darkly dark humor. You know, is that some headline writer's idea of a joke because many seniors are dead? But I think he's trying to say they're not exercising as much outdoors. Look, you need to go out and get your relief factor.com if you're a senior, if you're a junior, if you're an athlete. Icarian and Kirkman Resveratrol Omega. Take that. And then you won't be less active by means of aches and pains that you don't like to engage every day. Get rid of them. Away aches and pains. ReliefFactor.com. It works. 1995 gets it started. Selena, the injury report is next. America, stay tuned.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Birch Gold Group. Streaming on Salem Now.
¿Cuánto queda?
No queda nada. Que lo siento mucho.
Have you ever thought of going to seminary?
Madre, padre, ¿quién está listo para ser transformado por el poder de su palabra?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com. Streaming on Salem Now.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys. Never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery.
He said, listen, I gotta give these niggas enough. Not too much, but enough that I have them voting Democrat for the next 200 years.
The race grievance industry would have you believe that blacks get up and think about nothing else except race.
If I tell you this is racist, yeah. I'm gonna get you emotional.
There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd, a bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, 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 racist. Everything's racist.
It's the devil!
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
When you had the president in Atlanta saying to the crowd there that, you know, he didn't march in the shoes of the students that are marching today, but that he marched in the civil rights movement, and he remembers the first time he got arrested, when he never marched in any civil rights movement and has never been arrested.
I mean, can we even believe this? That he routinely says things that everyone knows are made up. Nobody calls him on it. Look, this is why you do your program, I do my program. We need to do our best to get the truth out. And we have to be clear, the president, he's plumb loco. I don't know what is going on. I guess I would say this, I'll bet that within his administration, there is very nasty fighting because they see what we see. I'm sure Kamala Harris despises the Biden gang, and the Biden gang despises her. They have to keep that quiet. But it's really something that...
Welcome back, America. Selena Zito is America's columnist right from the heart of Yinzerland, Western Pennsylvania, which may have power or not. Tennessee doesn't. Good morning, Selena Zito. Do you have power in Pittsburgh?
I do have power in Pittsburgh.
Okay, well, that's good because Tennessee ain't got it. Selena, your Washington Examiner column, The Covenant Between Main Street Consumer and Big Corporations is Collapsing, sort of must reading for elected officials. Would you do thesis statement and summarize for it?
Well, it's the covenant between the two entities who we buy our products from and who makes our products is shattered, is broken, because we don't, there's no connection between the two, because who makes our stuff in a bigger and big entities doesn't live anywhere near us. So they don't know us. And that, and when that is broken, when that relationship is broken, it's very similar to how broken our relationship is with government, with institutions, with academia. We don't have any cultural connection.
So I want to pick up on this. I want to begin by saying, at one point in your column, you write that nowadays people find themselves using or buying products made in plants in this country that are run by a board of directors who only fly in and out of the facility once a year for a board meeting. Now, I want to say that that is true for a lot of companies. It's true that they never visit some, but there are companies that have every board meeting near the factory floor. And my sister-in-law is an HBS grad and younger than I am. That's all she does is boards now. She got up to number two in Bean, and all she does is fly around and do boards now. And they always go to production plants. So it's not always true, but I think it is true mostly for most production plants in the United States. Because if you're Coca-Cola, you've got 100 of them, right? Or 10. I don't know how many.
Yeah, that's true. So think about Hoover Vacuum Company, Canton, Ohio, right? Was it Canton or Akron?
I should know that.
Anyways, Mr. Hoover lived four blocks from his, I mean, everybody knows what the Hoover vacuum cleaner is. He lived four blocks from his plant. He, you know, not only knew everyone that worked for him, he also knew everyone that bought his product. He was in church with them every Sunday. His wife was on the school board. There was this connection. So when he was making his, when he was thinking about his vacuum cleaners, all he had to do was look across his shoulder and to see how, the people were using them in his neighborhood.
Yeah, that's like Halsey Taylor drinking fountains. Every ring around the middle of the drinking fountain had Halsey Taylor made in Warren, Ohio.
Right.
Everybody knew the Halsey Taylor. Everybody knew him. You could find them. You could tell them their drinking fountains were great. They never broke. They were great.
Yeah. You don't know these. You don't know people that way that make you the thing.
I know Ben and Jerry are out of their minds somewhere up in Vermont.
That's because they make sure everybody knows they're out of their minds.
Yeah, I mean they go away. They're apologizing for Chinese totalitarianism or Russian expansionism this weekend. So, Salena, how did this go over? Actually, you went and you talked to a lot of people for this. Generally. Woke corporate America ain't coming back, is it?
It's lost its relationship with people. What's interesting to me, these are one of the things that I qualify, even though the story was about Penzi Spices and about the owner, Bill Penzi Jr., having a all Republicans are racist special.
Yes.
Unbelievable anybody would do that. But it's not even a Democrat Republican thing. It's an inside outside thing. And what it is doing, and we saw this leading up to 2016, and we saw even in 2020, and when you look down ballot, it's pushing people to the right that normally would not intuitively go right.
Very quickly. Very firmly. Woke is going to be broke, I think, Salena.
Yeah, absolutely true. Unfortunately.
Have you watched 1 minute of the Olympics?
No.
No, and you say that with the disdain that apparently America is reacting to it. They want nothing to do with CCP or the sponsors of the Olympics, but I want to know who they are because I don't want to buy their products. It's like Coca-Cola, Delta, and Major League Baseball screwing at Georgia.
Yep.
I just want, and those three had no idea what they were going to get the blowback.
No, they were absolutely clueless because you know what? They don't know their customers.
That's
the people that sit in their seats or drink their soda, or as we call it, pop around here.
Yeah, I know you do call it pop, but that's because two-syllable words tax the Pittsburgher's genuine ability. Pittsburgher took them a long time. So, Salena, the last thing is, I did two debates in Arizona, and I asked the candidates if they had been vaccinated and boosted. You're a good plumb line? Is that a legit question if you've got a booster?
I don't know.
Think about it. Now, Donald Trump said you should answer the question, so I asked the question, and I got booed. I think it's legit, and then the follow-up is obviously why, one way or the other. But they all said it's none of your business. I said, you're running for governor. We'll see. Think about it. Salena Zito is the plumb line on kind of sweet reason in the middle of the country, even in syllable-free Pittsburgh. SelenaZito.com. I'll be right back, America. Hour number two. Chris Christie coming up on the Hugh Hewitt Show, Monday edition, February 7.
Now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
When you had the president in Atlanta saying to the crowd there that, you know, he didn't march in the shoes of the students that are marching today, but that he marched in the civil rights movement, and he remembers the first time he got arrested, when he never marched in any civil rights movement and has never been arrested.
I mean, can we even believe this? That he routinely says things that everyone knows are made up. Nobody calls him on it. Look, this is why you do your program, I do my program. We need to do our best to get the truth out. And we have to be clear, the president, he's plumb loco. I don't know what is going on. I guess I would say this. I'll bet that within his administration, there is very nasty fighting because they see what we see. I'm sure Kamala Harris despises the Biden gang, and the Biden gang despises her. They have to keep that quiet. But it's really something that I think they're going to consume their own.
The Democratic Party knows that they're in trouble. When you say that their staff sees what's going on and we all see it, we got to remember one other thing. Vladimir Putin, Premier Xi, the leader of North Korea, the leader of Iran, these people all see it too. And there is a message being sent globally that America is a laughingstock right now, that the bowl of mashed potatoes that serves as the president in the White House right now is nothing more than a suit.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
Could you let that happen for 10 weeks of your children being kept in a box in the library, excluded, put on display, and so on and so forth for that long? I kind of feel like, and I can tell you are a very caring mom, which is why you're bringing this public, but I kind of feel like that would happen for 2 hours, and I would be down there at that school and pulling my kid out, much less 2 to 10 weeks. Did they really endure that for that long?
They really did that for that long. And I really appreciate that question. And I've gotten that question a lot. And how we looked at it as a family is we could pull them and just go about our lives and they'll just do this to someone else, or we could stay and fight and hold our ground. And my kids didn't want to leave that school. They've been in that school, my son, since first grade to eighth grade. They had their friends there. We still had hope that the trusted adults would do the right thing. And we eventually have pulled them to homeschool. But during those weeks, we were fighting. We have hundreds of emails to the administration, the Dallas ISD school board. We went down and I brought 30 or 40 grandmas and grandpas and other parents from other schools down to fight and speak on our behalf. Parents even scheduled protests, 3 protests outside the school. So we were fighting, but I think at this point in our country, the war has come into the family, and our kids can no longer be shielded from it. They needed to be guided through it, which we did as a family, to build a backbone and learn how to stand up and fight, because this is their next generation. So instead of shielding them from it, we helped them move through it with grace, integrity, and dignity, and they came out stronger.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
You called your son. You personally promised him you would be here.
Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work, if you believe.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with a clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with two senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, two former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet, with 3 years to go, is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Look at you! Ow! Hey, look at that! I wasn't ready for that.
And there goes Peter Dinklage beating the crap out of Will Ferrell for calling him an angry elf. I mean, listen, he's certainly not an elf, but he's an angry guy. You know, I hate to put everything in a political perspective here, but isn't it true? And I assume Peter Dinklage is no conservative. He's woke. He wants to cancel Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Why do they always want to cancel everything? You know, they want to cancel everything. What do conservatives believe in? We are for things. Biden's always saying, "What are Republicans for? Not for anything." Yes, we're for everything. We're for people. We're for people's right to make decisions about their health. We're for movies. We're for different views on the airwaves. We're not for people being canceled or movies being canceled or things being canceled. We're for things. And your side, Biden, is against everything. You're against Snow White, the Seven Dwarves. Oh, I mean, Disney obviously taking it seriously because they're redoing the whole movie, I guess. Do you portray them as children? Should child actors play the Seven Dwarves? You're going to get little Billy or Susie, who's about 9? The Seven Dwarves in Snow White aren't children. Grumpy isn't a kid. I mean, in fact, that would be a great, if they're casting people, maybe Peter Dinklage can play Grumpy. Because he bit right in.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
This is a story of how a million children were placed with local foster families through an unlikely alliance between the Chinese government and a British footballer. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans. With unprecedented access across the country, this is a unique insight into the lives of the 90s orphans now driving the 21st century's fastest growing economy.
This story needs to be told across the world. At a time where there's so much negativity and cynicism, here's proof that a single leap of faith can change the world.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Schools are lining up to push the transgender agenda on kids and cut parents out of the equation.
Go to salemnow.com.
Thank you. morning, Glory America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. Greetings from the West Coast on Monday, February 7th in the year of our Lord. I'm Hugh Hewitt live, joined by Jake Sherman of Punchbowl News. Now, I read my Punchbowl News email every morning. You should as well. Jake and team cover Congress like nobody else. And I've discovered, Jake, good morning. How are you?
I'm well, Hugh. How are you?
Good. I had a revelation about Punchbowl News. Because you cover a closely divided Congress, you are the least divorced from the reality of America of any news outlet that is Beltway-based, because the Manhattan Beltway media elite generally just gets the blue signal, the blue demand signal. You have to get the red demand signal because you have to talk to them.
Yeah, I've always made the point to people who criticize us and others for being biased for the left that what good does that serve me if I need to get Republicans to talk to me? I don't.
You are not. You know. I have problems with Politico and I have problems with Axios. I love Jonathan Swan. I love people at Politico as well, but I think they've gone left. You haven't. You're just reporting Congress. And it was struck me today when I read it this morning, and you're the only person in America who has put their finger on the most important question congressionally, and it is, when does Senator Lujan come back? Our New Mexico senator, and we say a prayer for him, had a stroke. And you write this morning, with Lujan out for at least the next few weeks, Schumer can't move in a nomination that requires 50 votes for 50 Senate Democrats to be present, which also means that reconciliation bills in whatever form are out as well. It's a huge deal, and you've got it. So now dial me in. What do you know about Senator Lujan's condition? Because America's media has not covered itself in glory in telling us this.
Well, it's a delicate situation, obviously, for the media and for other people, because he's obviously suffered quite a serious bout with, a stroke. But they told us last week that he'll be back within 4 to 6 weeks. I don't have any clue. I'm not a doctor. I haven't examined his condition. I don't know his doctors, but I remember we have two examples of senators who have been out with strokes before. That's Mark Kirk of Illinois, Republican of Illinois, and Tim Johnson, Democrat of South Dakota, both of whom had strokes while in office. And they both came back after several months' absence, is my recollection. But right now, Mitch McConnell is the functional majority leader, although he doesn't have the power to do anything. He has more votes. So if you look at what they could do, it's very limited. I mean, besides passing government funding, which they need to do in the next 11 days, I'm really not quite sure what they can do when it comes to just basic governing, the blocking and tackling of governing.
So, Jake, my question, are you skeptical of the information we have been given about Senator Lujan's return schedule?
I'm skeptical about everything, Hugh.
So, yeah, I know that. I am very skeptical. And I prayed for the guy this morning because stroke is tough. It scares me more than almost anything else. That's why I walk. So I don't want to have a stroke. And Mark Kirk and Tim Johnson are examples of why not. But it is of national interest. It is of great consequence to the Ukrainians. It is of great consequence to the Supreme Court. Whether or not he's coming back, doesn't somebody owe us a lot more information, like when Donald Trump went to the hospital?
Well, I will say this. We didn't find out until 5 days after he had the stroke. He had surgery to relieve swelling in his brain. So he's had brain surgery. And we asked Martin Heinrich, the other Democrat from New Mexico, senator from New Mexico, who was also in the House of Representatives. They both were in the House of Representatives. We asked him about his condition. And he kind of said, you know, you guys are ridiculous. You know, I'm not answering, blah, 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 you know, that kind of thing. So, you know, it would be nice to have a little bit more information for sure, because this is the health of a public official. Now, I had a very prominent Republican senator say to me the other day, they disagree with me. He has the right to his privacy. And if he was governor of a state, it would be different because he's in charge of a state. Senate, they view a little bit differently. But I mean, I think Democrats would like to know more. Democrats don't really know what's going on. And again, very serious.
Senators are very protective of senators. You and I both know that that's a club, and R&D don't matter much inside the club. They take care of each other. They love each other. They're friends. They know each other's spouses. And I'm not denying that at all. And normally that would be the correct response. But he isn't the president. He is the deciding vote on the majority in the Senate, though. If Mitch McConnell is the de facto majority leader until Senator Lujan comes back. Am I right?
Yeah, he can't bring things to the floor necessarily, absent some, you know, bizarre procedural maneuver. And Schumer's going to have to keep a tight grip on the floor because he doesn't have the votes. So, you know, time is ticking, Hugh. I mean, we're in February of an election year, and let's say he's back in March. There's just a lot going on. I mean, as you noted, the Russia sanctions are absolutely gigantic. That's going to have to be worked out. Government funding is going to have to be worked out. If you're want some form of Build Back Better, although under a different name with different policy, that is going to require Lujan's presence. So there's just a lot riding on the on Lujan's absence. And again, I hope he's doing well, but there's a lot riding on it.
Okay, we've said that both enough that people will now understand when I say the media is not doing its job. If this was a Republican in a 50-49 Senate, the progressive left would be demanding that Chuck Schumer, you know, grab the gavel and take over from Majority Leader McConnell. I'm not suggesting Leader McConnell do that. I'm suggesting that the media needs to let us know how long the United States Senate is paralyzed. Because there is one option that I haven't seen the left argue for this yet, which is Senator Lujan resign, we'll appoint a Democratic governor, we'll appoint a placekeeper, and when you're better, they will resign, and you can go back. I'll appoint you again. Isn't that the way forward?
Yeah, there's no reason he cannot do that. There's no reason. And I would imagine if this...
Jake, you just broke up there.
Talked about?
What did you imagine you just broke up there? You would imagine, yeah, what?
I would imagine that if it goes on for much longer, then yes, then that will have to be something that they talk about. There's no reason why Lujan can't step down. They can't appoint somebody, and then when he's better, he comes back. But again, we're only a week into this, and they say between 4 and 6 weeks, so we'll have to see. If it gets to 6 weeks and he's not back, then that's something we'll have to start asking people. And believe me, we're asking people every day. Very few people want to answer about it. They say it's mild, and I understand that. But you're right, the Senate is paralyzed at the moment.
So the appropriate question is, without disclosing any personal details, what is your level of certainty that he will be back after 6 weeks? That's the question. Yeah. Because if it's under 50%, I honestly do not know what the media people need to know. Okay, Jake, now talk to me about defense spending, because this equity with defense nonsense, we are holding up the Defense Authorization Act, $25 billion in additional spending and crippling the Pentagon. Who is demanding that we not appropriate money for the Pentagon?
No, I think the better way to say it is Democrats are demanding, Republicans and Democrats both demand of each other, any spending has to be accompanied with an increase in social spending. Obviously, Democrats want the increase in social spending to go along with the $25 billion increase in defense spending. That is there will be people on the left who don't agree with the increase in defense spending. There will be people on the right who don't agree with the social spending, obviously. Now, listen, here's the thing. Patrick Leahy, longtime senator from Vermont, is the Senate Appropriations Chair, and Richard Shelby is the top Republican. Both men are retiring at the end of this year, and this is a swan song for them to get all sorts of spending through. And as you know, Hugh, appropriators aren't Republicans or Democrats. They're appropriators. They like spending money regardless of the party. So I would have to imagine that they do get a deal, but you're right. There's a big point of contention between Republicans and Democrats over this idea of spending parity, increasing defense spending at the same level of increasing social spending. And both sides are arguing for that.
All right, last question, Jake. I made the observation earlier, Marco Rubio said this to Margaret Brennan on Face the Nation yesterday, the January 6th committee has no purchase with the center right in America. I mean, it's a rump committee. It's it's not legit. They suppress the rights of the minority. I know there are two Republicans on it, and people have mixed. Liz Cheney's a friend of mine. I don't know Adam Kinzinger from Adam Kinzinger, but I just wonder, is Congress aware that the American people do not care, except
they're trying to get people to care? And I would make the argument, Hugh, and this is a place where I'll be very, very critical of Republicans. McCarthy, Kevin McCarthy and Mitch McConnell could have had complete veto authority over subpoenas if they had accepted the original proposal on this committee. They could have been completely involved and completely in the driver's seat, and they're not. And they do shoulder some blame on that.
Actually, no, Jake, I got to push back. I want you to get the last word in. Once that bill failed, for reasons that I agree with, it became an issue for Nancy Pelosi on how to set up an investigatory select committee for which there are many precedents, all of which she broke. She can't run away from that.
That you're not wrong that she did design it after that. You're absolutely right. I would argue that the preceding event was dispositive as well.
That's next week, Jake, because you can't repeal a precedent of the House that is hundreds of years old and recently exercised because you're Nancy Pelosi. It's just, the country doesn't care. You can't make them care. We don't care. We're not going to care. Arrest the people. Try the people. Be done with January 6th. Get Punchbowl News, though. Punchbowlnews.com. I'll be right back, America. Prayers for Senator Lujan. Questions for Senator Schumer when we return on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Peter Dinklage beating the crap out of Will Ferrell for calling him an angry elf. He's certainly not an elf, but he's an angry guy. You know, I hate to put everything in a political perspective here, but isn't it true? And I assume Peter Dinklage is no conservative. He's woke. He wants to cancel Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Why do they always want to cancel everything? You know, they want to cancel everything. What do conservatives believe in? We are for things. Biden's always saying, what are Republicans for? Not for anything. Yes, we're for everything. We're for people. We're for people's right to make decisions about their health. We're for movies. We're for different views on the airwaves. We're not for people being canceled or movies being canceled or things being canceled. We're for things. And your side, Biden, is against everything. You're against Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. Oh, I mean, Disney obviously taking it seriously because they're redoing the whole movie, I guess. Do you portray them as children? Should child actors play the Seven Dwarves? You're going to get little Billy or Susie, who's about 9? The Seven Dwarves in Snow White aren't children. Grumpy isn't a kid. I mean, in fact, that would be a great, if they're casting people, maybe Peter Dinklage can play Grumpy. Because he fit right in.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
So I think in their strategy meeting, they said, okay, people say that Joe Biden's mental decline is impacting his ability to govern. Let's shoot Joe up with whatever sort of kind of adrenaline that is necessary and deploy him out there. I think the point was to try to show that Joe Biden was going to go over the top long to try to win kudos and praise from the establishment media. This is his first press conference I think he's done in quite some time. Some people said it was his first ever press conference as president. Second? Okay. That was his second press conference. Trump used to do these almost daily. He did them for fun. And I will say, for reasons that we can speculate, the media was pretty critical. They were direct, precise. Now, nowhere even in the ecosystem, nowhere even in the atmosphere of questions towards Donald Trump. And I agree with my friend Tucker Carlson. The press conference was totally weird. It was a strange deal. Joe Biden leaning in, he does this thing where he kind of like hunches over the podium. You notice that, Connor? And he kind of puts both of his arms down and he looks directly at the reporter. And then he whispers, you're exactly right. And he was still calling from a pre-selected list of reporters. And there were multiple blunders that came out of that. But if the point was to try to show the nation, look, hey, if you have any concerns about how sharp this guy is mentally, I mean, come on. He stood there and talked for 2 hours. I don't think that mission was accomplished.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Somebody check on Brian Westbury. I'm Hugh Hewitt. The story this weekend on the Federal Reserve's rejection of monetarism is so disturbing. Doesn't matter what the money supply is. And that's a buy signal for gold. Birch Gold is where you do that, by the way. www.hughgold.com or text my name, Hugh, to 989898. They don't believe in monetarism anymore. Gold this morning is at $1,811 an ounce. The 10-year treasury has broken through 1.9. That's now 1.93. At the beginning of the year, it's 1.2. So you do the math. If you're in Pittsburgh, that's a lot. And that means inflation is here, and you better go buy your house. You better get out of CDs from last year. You're going to have to be nimble because inflation is here. Gold is at 1811. The stock market report brought to you by Birch Gold from Friday was interesting. The Dow was down 21. The S&P was up 23. And the NASDAQ was up 219. Now, one of my two stocks, Palantir is the other, is Amazon, which I have not bought or sold in a decade because it's a reserve currency for the world. And it went up $375 a share, which is a 13.5% jump on Friday because they're raising the cost of Prime and their Amazon Web Services continues to win and everything continues to win and they've weathered the pandemic. And I don't know what they're going to do today, but I know that Amazon is a reserve currency against inflation and gold is the original reserve currency against the currency being watered down. That's when Rome used to cheat people is when they would add a little lead to their silver. And if you shave the edge off of gold, you were cheating people. Gold is still gold. Put it in your safety deposit box or create an IRA or 401k organized and legit in the eyes of the IRS through Birch Gold. www.hughgold.com or text my name Hugh to 989898. Inflation is here. Let me also tell you, I want to read through you the fact check. Fact check, Mike Pence did not have the power to overturn the 2020 election results, keep Trump in office. That's from USA Today, that is correct. The pandemic has many seniors less active. Hold that for relief factor. Democrats' big dilemma, this is funny. Avoid Biden or embrace him. That is not a dilemma. The man has got the lowest ratings of a president in the millennia at the same time in a term. So we're up against Bush, Obama, and Trump in their 13th month, and Biden is lower than all of them. Avoid Biden or embrace him? Really? Really? Not really a question. Andrew Cuomo plans comeback. That's like Dwayne planning to be a singer. He doesn't have the band experience I do, but he might want to get into it. Dwayne, do you play the bass? Is Dwayne go home?
No, I don't.
You don't play the bass. Okay, so if you wanted to play the bass, how long would that take you?
You can play the bass quickly in not very long period of time. To play it well takes decades.
Okay, so now Andrew Cuomo is planning a comeback. Do you think you could learn to play the bass well before Andrew Cuomo makes a comeback? Because I'm saying yes.
I could play the bass well and probably the drums and trumpet, too.
Well, I do the trumpet. Leave this stuff for me that is mine. But Andrew Cuomo is not coming back. Then there's a story on climate change enters the therapy room. I got to cover that, too. But first, relieffactor.com. You heard me tell the story. Coming up after the break, Chris Christie. Don't miss that. The pandemic has made many seniors less active, according to the New York Times this morning. You know what? No, it hasn't. I see seniors every day out there walking, talking, but I'm in California. The weather has made people less active in Tennessee and places. Get your relief factor. Go to the gym. Get outside, walk, run, trundle, swim, golf, whatever it is you do, do it with relieffactor.com. You'll feel better about it. You'll go longer. You'll feel better. And when we come back, I've got a lot more to talk to Chris Christie about. He made a lot of news yesterday with his comments on this week, and I'll be talking to him about that. But during the break, head to relieffactor.com and don't sleep on it. Don't sleep on it. Because you keep making you keep telling yourself, I'm going to get relieffactor.com, and then you don't. You're lazy. I'm lazy too, but I'm not that lazy. I get out and go my miles. Relieffactor.com, relieffactor.com. Coming right back with Chris Christie. Don't go anywhere, America. It's the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Curious about what you're missing in the universe? The After Show? 21 years of Hugh Hewitt shows on demand? Go to www.universe.com right now, where it's only 99 cents to join for the first month. www.universe.com.
Powerful organs of the state are not merely corrupt, but that they've been weaponized to go after perceived domestic enemies. And that's very scary.
Our constitutional democracy enshrines the peaceful transfer of power.
We are now all rooting for his success. The peaceful transition of power is one of the hallmarks of our democracy.
We don't live in the United States of America as any of us would like to understand it.
We have a peaceful transition of power process. That's not what happened.
They interviewed General Flynn, and they did it in what was a complete ambush.
I thought, it's early enough, let's just send a couple guys over.
And the audience was, ha 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 ha. How funny to set up an innocent man.
This is what third world security states do. They spy on their political opponents like this.
This is part of a concerted Russian influence operation.
Russian interference.
They colluded. They were in on it.
He would constantly say, I have seen evidence of collusion.
Until this is released, I can't comment.
I can't go into the particulars.
Russians, I'm not going to be specific.
But he knew he could just say it on TV and then hide behind, well, it's all classified, I can't get into it.
Well, it's classified, you can't see it.
Collusion, you just got to be willing to see it.
New York's Daily News ran this front page, Trump is Hitler.
How could 62 million Americans vote for Hitler? Are 62 million Americans Nazis?
We really almost thought it was a joke. Like, really, you're not gonna accept that you lost this election?
Then they see the Russia collusion narrative sitting right there in front of them and say, why don't we just say that he cheated?
It divided the country in ways that people can't imagine. It's inspired massive violence. It's given people who are bad faith actors a license to do whatever they want because they literally feel like they're fighting Russian spies and Nazis.
Russiagate has been the most egregious abuse of everything that was supposed to have been good about our government.
The thing that they were investigating the Trump campaign for is what they themselves were doing.
Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Operations, you find that they have this concept that loosely translated English means big help with a little bad mouth. And basically what that means is they're willing to allow people they do deals with in Congress, the Biden family, on Capitol Hill, Wall Street, they're willing to allow those individuals to provide some criticism because they recognize that it maintains credibility for those individuals.
Wow. Wow.
What they don't want, Dennis, is for them to sort of go to the third rail, which is number one, cut off Chinese access to Western capital markets and restrict the flow of technology, not stolen technology, but technology given to China. They don't want those two elements stopped.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com.
Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys, never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery. There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd, a bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, racist, racist. Everything's racist.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt live on Monday the 7th. I'm on the West Coast, so it's early. Governor Chris Christie, I assume, is on the East Coast. Good morning, Governor. Welcome back to the Hugh Hewitt Show and the interview.
Happy to be back, Hugh, and I am on the East Coast and ready to go with a good day.
All right, good. First question, Knicks or Nets for Governor Christie?
Knicks.
Okay, so I want you to know the Cavaliers are way ahead of them both. That's what I wanted to let you know. Governor.
That's not hard, Hugh.
Well, it is for Cleveland. You haven't been watching the Cavaliers since LeBron left. Anyway, let's play for the audience what you told Martha Raddatz yesterday, prompting my invitation to you yesterday. Cut number one, Chris Christie on This Week on ABC with Martha Raddatz hosting yesterday.
Well, look, Martha, I think that the actions the vice president took on January 6th spoke loudly, and I'm glad he's finally put words to it. I don't know why it took him so long, but I'm glad that he did. And let's face it, let's call this what it is. January 6th was a riot that was incited by Donald Trump in an effort to intimidate Mike Pence and the Congress into doing exactly what he said in his own words last week, overturn the election. Now, he's tried to do a cleanup on aisle one here and correcting that stuff, but it's not going to change. He actually told the truth by accident. He wanted the election to be overturned. Donald Trump did respond to what the vice president said. And I think it's kind of akin to the kid standing in the corner holding his breath. You know, it's immature, and it's beneath the office that he held.
So, Governor, did the former president call you yesterday?
He did not.
Do you expect to call soon?
You know, you never know, Hugh. He's knowing him for 20 years and being his friend for 20 years, you never know when you're going to get a call or you're not, when he's upset about something. But, look, what I said yesterday is the truth. And my biggest concern about all this is, while Joe Biden and his administration is doing things to this country that may be undoable, and Republicans should be solely focused on that, we still got the folks at the RNC focusing on this stuff, and then all weekend we have commentators asking us these questions, and rightfully so because of the actions of the RNC. We as a party should be focused on our plan for the future and how we're going to change and stop what Joe Biden's doing to this country.
Now, Governor, I the RNC did a lot of things, and we'll come back to that. I want to focus on the legal issue that maybe Martha didn't hear you say. Incite is a legal term. Do you think actual and proximate causation of the riot and the people who trespassed into the Congress, does causation flow to the president, former president?
Look, I think due to his conduct, Hugh, not on January 6th necessarily, but the conduct from election night forward. I think when you're going to hear testimony from many of those folks who were up there, they're going to tell you they went there because that's what Donald Trump told them to do. And so I think he's got a he's got an issue in that regard. There's no doubt. Now, is it a slam dunk? It is not, as is always the case, as you know, with these type of issues. But to me, it's less important as a legal issue than it is as a policy and political issue.
Well, I agree with that, but let's you've got legal chops. Very few people do. I can talk to you, Pompeo, Cotton, and DeSantis about the law, so I want to talk to you about the law. Is he liable? Is he potentially liable for any wrongful death action or damages done to the Capitol in tort?
He's potentially liable for that, although I think he's down on the causation chain from the folks who were actually there and committing the acts of violence.
Do you remember Paul's graph?
Yes.
Okay, where is he on the train track?
Look, I think that the conduct that happened was foreseeable, given that he's been telling people you've got to fight for your country and go up to Capitol Hill and fight for your country. You know, words matter, Hugh. Words matter under the law, words matter in politics, and words matter when they come out of the mouth of the President of the United States.
Do you think he intended the 725 people who have been charged with one crime or another to break into the Capitol?
I don't think he intended that specific act, Hugh.
He's told me he didn't. He's told me on the air that he didn't.
I don't think he intended that, but I think what he intended, and his words this past week support this, that he was attempting to set up a situation to intimidate Mike Pence and intimidate the members of Congress into voting to overturn the election. His words, overturn the election, Hugh.
Okay, and what was his speech?
Words.
Was his speech protected under the Brandenburg test, which we can explain to the Steelers fans later?
I believe his speech was protected. That's why I say that when you look at the causation chain, him saying the things he was saying from Election Day forward is what causes the problems.
All right. Now, I want to switch over to the vice president, former vice president's statement. I want to play it for people. Cut number 11 from the Federalist Society last week.
President Trump is wrong. I had no right to overturn the election. The presidency belongs to the American people and the American people alone. And frankly, there is no idea more un-American than the notion that any one person could choose the American president. Under the Constitution, I had no right to change the outcome of our election.
Now, this is a legal question, Governor Christie, and again, you're a prosecutor with chops. Is Mike Pence right on the law?
Yes, he is.
Is there any doubt in your mind?
Not a scintilla of doubt in my mind that the Electoral Count Act is something that's ministerial. It is not something where the Vice President of the United States is there making a qualitative or political judgment as to the electoral votes that come in certified by the individual states.
A ministerial act.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, and that is a legal, I agree with your assessment. I've always agreed with your assessment. However, I'm also aware in 2016 that Lawrence Tribe and Lessig, a couple of Harvard law profs were out there trying to get faithless electors to switch their votes after their slates have been certified. Minnesota Post columnist Eric Black wrote about it. Didn't all this craziness begin in 2000, get worse in 2004, and metastasize in 2016 so that it became the 2020 riot?
I think all of those things were, what I talk about is the Democrats started this in 2000 by calling George W. Bush an illegitimate president. And they're the ones who began down this road of illegitimacy. And by the way, we had votes in 2000, as you know, to not certify the vote by Democrats in the House with the George W. Bush Al Gore election. And it continued from there. Continued in 08, 04, 08, and 16. And then 20 being kind of the pinnacle, at least to date, of that kind of activity.
So it's a bad road that we're on, but I want people to understand the Electoral Count Act is not really ambiguous. Now, I moderated two debates, Governor, in Arizona on Saturday. For the Arizona would-be GOP nominees, 4 out of 5, and for all 4 would-be Arizona GOP governor nominees. I asked the 4 Senate would-be nominees if they agreed with Mike Pence or Donald Trump on the Electoral Count Act. 3 out of the 4 agree with Donald Trump. What does that tell you?
Well, it tells me that in Arizona, there are people more afraid of crossing Donald Trump and what that will do in their ability to win the primary than they are in telling the truth.
Now, I also asked the governor candidates, all 4 of them. I got booed. I don't like getting booed. You remember? You might not remember. I got booed when I asked Ben Carson if he could actually drop a nuclear weapon on somebody. But so I got booed when I asked the candidates what they thought of vaccines and if they had been boosted. And I looked at the audience and said, President Trump said you should answer this question. Cut number 13.
Well, I've taken it. I've had the booster. Many politicians, I watched a couple of politicians be interviewed. And one of the questions was, did you get the booster? Because they had the vaccine. And they're answering it like, in other words, the answer is yes, but they don't want to say it. Because they're gutless. You got to say it. Whether you had it or not, say it. Right. But the fact is,
Governor Christie, I don't think they're gutless. I think they're afraid of Trump voters. Because I got told I was making up what the president said. I mean, MAGA people were mad at me, telling me that the president didn't say that. What is going on here? People who believe Trump on the Electoral Count Act and disbelieve the former president on boosters. It doesn't make any sense.
There's a segment of our population out there right now, Hugh, who just hears what they want to hear. And interpret things they want to interpret. Look, the former president has been very clear about his belief in vaccines and vaccination. That's why he started, rightfully, Operation Warp Speed, funded it the way he did, and brought about, through the work that he did in supporting those scientists, the vaccines we have and the booster we have now. He's done it, he's taken it, and he's recommending to others that they do the same. And for public officials, I think, you know, Trump is doing something very responsible here, which is to say, you've got to lead. And whatever your answer is, whether you took the booster or you didn't, you should be telling people so they can make a judgment and evaluation. I think this is nonsense. All of it is nonsense.
It is. It's crazy.
How divided we are.
You cannot actually hold both positions and wear a MAGA hat. The MAGA hat says you got to be wrong on the Electoral Count Act and wrong on the booster. To me, now I just don't get it. Go ahead, Governor.
I don't get it either, Hugh. And I think that it's part of why we have to get back talking about facts. We have to get back to talking about not feelings anymore. And this is where we get into trouble when we're talking about the 2020 election. And all flows from that, in my view. And this distrust that we continue to stir with the government. They've earned a lot of it, Hugh, but we shouldn't be stoking it.
I also asked each candidate on the Senate debate, I think, did President Biden win a constitutional majority in the Electoral College? If not, which states do you question? If so, how firm is your authority? I want to ask you, Governor Christie, did Joe Biden win an electoral majority in a constitutional majority in the Electoral College?
Yes.
How soon were you certain of that fact?
By probably 2 weeks after the election.
Okay, I was pretty certain the next day because I written a book. If you're behind in 4 states, you're not going to win. It's just the reality of cheating in America. You got to be within 1,000 votes, and he wasn't within 1,000 votes in any of those states, I don't think. Let me ask you now, and I like the former president. I think he's done a great thing on boosters. I think he did a great thing on a lot of things, and his Supreme Court we're about to get to. Before I go to the RNC, do you expect anyone to run for president not named Christie or Hogan if President Trump gets into the primary?
Sure.
Who?
I think Pompeo will run.
Oh.
My guess. I think he would run. I think Pence will run.
That's going to be an interesting set of debates.
It sure will be, and hopefully we get good questioners like you who are asking questions and allowed to follow up so you can test what the candidates really know and what they don't.
Now, that's a non-fungible token for Chris Christie there. We like that plug. However, when it comes down to it, do you think the president will engage in primary debates given his numbers?
Well, I think he likes it. I can tell you, I think he likes it. I think he likes the back and forth, and I don't think he would like to be characterized by anybody who might be running against him he's afraid to do it. And so knowing Donald Trump as well as I do, for as long as I do, I think he will engage.
Okay, now I'm going to take Chris Christie into the break, talk to him during the break, and bring him back on the other end. That's an audience note. When Dobbs comes down, do you expect it to overturn Roe and Casey, Governor Christie?
I do.
And effectively 100% back to the states, or that just find a way to uphold the 15-week law?
Well, look, I think that John Roberts is desperately going to attempt to find a way to limit it to some extent to just the 15-week law. But I think that Roe is such a flawed decision, always has been, that this court is going to say, look, like Plessy versus Ferguson was flawed, Roe versus Wade is horribly flawed, and we need to overturn it.
Yeah, we disagree on predictions. I think the Chief Justice will overturn Roe. Casey, I'll be right back, America. Rejoined now by Governor Chris Christie. So, Governor, I want to go to the RNC. Everybody in elite media, Manhattan Beltway media especially, focused on the censure of Liz Cheney, my friend, and Adam Kinzinger, and they missed entirely the real big deal, which is they adopted rules saying we're not working with the Presidential Debate Commission. I can pretty much guarantee you that that's an issue, and that Liz and Adam are not going to be an issue in the fall of 2022 and in 2024. Why doesn't legacy media cover the big deal, and they only focus on the 9/11 Select Committee, which is actually illegitimate in my view?
Because what they do, as you know, is they focus on the things that they think will help their cause, and their cause is the cause of the Democratic Party. And so they don't want to talk about the inherent problems with the Presidential Debate Commission and what that's going to lead to in 2024. They'd rather continue to talk about January 6th. Look, Hugh, I have strong feelings about that. I've said them publicly. I said it again today on your show. But enough already. You know, we saw it. It reminds me of the old Marx Brothers routine. You know, are you going to believe me or your lying eyes? We all watched January 6th. We all know what happened. And I think that, but for legacy media, what they want to do is continue to push that and push it and push it, because they know that that's harmful to Republicans, and they can see that we're moving towards Republican majorities in the House and Senate without something, you know, cataclysmic happening. And that's what they're attempting to cause. And so that's why they do it. And you know it, and so do I.
I do. And I never talk about January 6th because I like my audience. I don't want them to turn me off. And they're bored. They do not like it. It is illegitimate. Nancy Pelosi quashed the minority. And yes, there are two Republicans on it. Liz Cheney's been a fine spokesperson for national security for years. I don't know Adam, but they're opposite their party on this, obviously. I just am curious. Do you think the blue bubble knows how absolutely uninterested America is in the January 6th Select Committee, which is actually a rump parliament gone wild?
No, I don't think they have any idea, because they live in their own world. And I said this right from the beginning, Hugh, from when the committee was established, that it had undercut its ability to be a credible investigative body when Nancy Pelosi refused to allow Kevin McCarthy to put the members on that he wanted to put on. And that's always been the right of the minority leader, whether it was a Republican or a Democrat. When she did it, she made it a partisan committee. And that's not saying anything against Liz, because like you, I have great respect for Liz. But the fact is that when she prevents the minority leader from putting the members on that he wants to put on, then she makes it a partisan committee, and it makes it very, very difficult for any American to really listen attentively to what they did, you know. Unlike, let's say, the Watergate committee, Hugh, as you know, from nearly 50 years ago, that was a committee where it was a truly bipartisan committee, appointed the right way to do an investigation of what went on.
You know, Senator, Governor, I'm older than you, and so I had to watch that in AP government during summer school. That's all we did it was the basketball coach. So we watched 4 hours of Watergate hearings. Those were interesting. let me ask you about Jeff Zucker leaving CNN, your reaction.
Look, I think that Jeff Zucker is somebody who has tried to manipulate the political process through his position in the media. And, you know, he left He resigned or got pushed out, whichever way it went. To me, hopefully CNN changes after this and stops becoming an advocacy arm for the Democratic Party.
Now, you know, Jeff is brilliant, and a friend of mine. I've never worked for him. He offered me a job once. I turned him down. I asked him for a job once. He turned me down. So that's the conflict disclosure. But he's brilliant. He's brilliant, brilliant, brilliant. But he made a bet, right? He wanted to be MSNBC light, and it didn't work.
Yep, exactly right. And look, same here. He offered me a job twice after I left the governorship. I said no both times, and I told him the reason was I couldn't come on there and be a credible voice given the kind of programming that he was running on CNN. And so, you know, I hope that as they go into the Discovery Channel and they become under different management, that perhaps they'll look at how failed the model is economically and from a news production perspective and decide once again to go back to being a network that shows both sides and isn't an advocacy arm for the Democratic Party. I doubt that will happen, but, you know, we live in hope.
Now, let's talk a little bit about ratings and NBC, my former employer. I'm no longer employed by NBC. They have the worst ratings in history for a Winter Olympics. Why is that, Chris Christie, and why doesn't NBC know what to do?
It's the worst ratings because, in my view, Hugh, we shouldn't be there. We're giving the Chinese dictator, murdering dictator, a platform to try to make his country and the way they run that country look like it's in with the League of Nations, and it's not.
No, it's a totalitarian. Do you believe in the genocide that Mike Pompeo had declared?
Well, there's no doubt that what's happening with the Uyghurs, the Uyghur Muslims, is a genocide. And remember, we went to an Olympics in 1936, Hugh, in the midst of a genocide. I think we were wrong then, and I think we're wrong now.
So in terms of the woke corporations that are sponsoring the Olympics, will they get the blowback that, for example, Coca-Cola, Delta, and Major League Baseball got for injecting themselves on the progressive side of the debate in Georgia about Georgia voting law?
Of course not. They won't, because the legacy media that you talked about will not gin it up like they ginned up this controversy in baseball and in Atlanta for the All-Star Game and Major League Baseball caved to it. If they won't do it, and when they don't do it, it makes it much more difficult for that kind of reaction and blowback to occur to these corporations. And Hugh, they know it, and that's why they continue to buy commercials on the Olympics. Although, with the ratings going the way they are so far, they may turn out to have made a bad investment.
Now, let me ask you, by the way, about Major League Baseball. I didn't watch it because of their choice, so I didn't see the All-Star Game. Was Frankie Lindor on that squad?
Oh, now see? Here you go, Hugh. We're going to get into a Guardians Mets conversation. No, he was not, nor did he deserve to be, given his first half performance, as you well know.
It's a fact based question, Governor. I got two more.
Of course.
I got two more. Redistricting. Yep. I actually admire the knife work done by the New York Democrats. I mean, it's sort of like watching the Duelist movie, and in Illinois. Does redistricting bother you? I mean, it never bothers me. This is the way it's supposed to be. I just wish legacy media would stop complaining about Texas and Florida and focus on the fact that New York has left the Republicans like the Black Knight Monty Python.
Listen, my view on it is that it would be better for the country overall if we kept the courts out of this and let the political institutions, the state legislatures in the main, be able to draw these lines and let them be judged up or down based on the work they do, both with Congress and the state legislatures. You know, I'm the co-chair of the Republican Redistricting Trust with Mike Pompeo, and we're going to be out there fighting hard to support Republicans all over the country who are trying to draw fair and constitutional maps. So that's the way I choose to be involved in it. I don't want to bemoan it and moan about it. I get involved and try to make a difference, Hugh. And that's the way I try to operate.
All right, last two questions. Do you expect the former president to run in 2024?
I think it's a total jump ball, Hugh. I really do. And I think that we have no idea right now. Like you know, I've known him for 20 years, been friends with him for that long. No matter what he says, I don't think he's anywhere near having made a final decision yet.
And a last question. Our thoughts and prayers are with Senator Lujan, who had a stroke. But he's the 50th vote. The Democrats run the Senate only by virtue of having all 50 Democrats show up. And the legacy media won't tell us what his condition is. Do we deserve transparency here?
Well, I think first and foremost, Hugh, the people of New Mexico deserve transparency. You know, he's their representative in the United States Senate, and they deserve transparency. I hope, as you said, that the senator is getting better and recovers. He's a young man, and to have that type of medical condition as such a young man is a really sad and desperate thing. But you know, everyone deserves to know what's his course of recovery. Will he be able to come back and be able to execute his responsibilities and his oath? And I think that the people of New Mexico, first and foremost, before any of the rest of us, are the ones who are deserving of knowing, because they're the ones who are counting on him to represent their interests in the United States Senate.
Did you see legacy media cover this at all?
No.
Did they cover the RNC? Did you see anywhere that the RNC's decision on Presidential Debate Commission get covered anywhere?
No.
And last question, do you approve of the RNC, and will you abide by it if you're the nominee? Will you reject the Presidential Debate Commission?
Look, I absolutely would, because in the end, I think there's been a lot of unfairness that has happened over the course of time. And by the way, there's no reason why the two major candidates for President of the United States, whoever they are, can't sit down themselves, negotiate rules, and put these debates on. No reason that can't be done.
Agree and agree. Governor Christie, always great to talk to you. Well done on ABC yesterday in terms of at least somewhere on mainstream media, we find someone who will say both good and bad about Donald Trump. I think you're the last island on the networks. Thank you, Chris Christie. Go Cavs.
A unicorn, Hugh. I'm a unicorn.
You are a unicorn. You're a unicorn on baseball, too, in that you're hoping for the Mets. Anyway, I appreciate your coming back, Governor. Be well.
Thank you, Hugh.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
Was Sonia Sotomayor saying to them that there were 100,000 children in hospitals, many of them on ventilators? Eric, I went and looked up the data immediately. If you follow me on Instagram, you know that I've posted regularly the death rates of COVID-positive people and heart disease and cancer. There are only 119,000 people hospitalized for COVID in the nation as we sat there that day. So you're saying 100,000 of them were children, when the data shows that only 5 children are hospitalized out of every 100,000 hospitalizations. There was maybe 6 kids in the hospital, none of them on ventilators that I could find.
100,000. Who's counting? Hey, we're all about grace, bro.
And it's a whole consistent pattern, Eric, that they used to do kind of in the shade. They would make more implications than direct statements. They wouldn't campaign on things that were factually false. The left has lost its rooting, its mooring, that's holding
it. But how many people do we know in the evangelical church who do not give a damn about this? They absolutely don't seem to understand that when leaders lie, when they do these kinds of things, it hurts people. It usually hurts poor people the most, and we have many in the evangelical church who have absolutely turned a blind eye. Again, this rises to levels unprecedented in American life. I mean, it's one thing to say we have differences. This is a level of political theater, of lying and grandstanding that is so pernicious to the fabric of the republic.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com.
Tesla was a genius. His most amazing discoveries thought to be written in a lost journal. Now in the right hands, it could revolutionize the 21st century. But in the wrong hands, kill him. Jump.
If you can stop an earthquake, doesn't that mean you could start one too?
That's why that notebook should never fall into the wrong hands.
There's an old brown battered notebook in my office at work. You have to find it, take it, and keep it hidden at all costs. The G20 leaders meeting downtown, they're in danger. In fact, the whole of downtown could be in danger.
If we are to build the superhuman, we must first eliminate those who are flawed.
People are created equally. All of downtown, the high-rises were built on rollers to withstand horizontal shakes. A vertical quake this size could collapse half of downtown.
We have commenced the countdown.
Shall we stop this thing?
Save the universe!
This is Carol Platt-Liebau for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Streaming on Salem Now.
The public would be outraged if they knew the truth.
Why do you think our politicians are not on the sidewalk right now talking to you?
No, I have no respect.
The old wall randomly turns into a guardrail, followed by miles of open border.
Human trafficking, but...
that journey is extremely dangerous.
The 7-year-old girl died in the desert.
From the country of India.
A great pillar of the community was killed by a man who had been deported at least twice.
This little urn contains the ashes of my son. His dreams cut short forever.
We're so worried about other countries' problems, and we don't even focus on our own.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com. Streaming on Salem Now.
We'll see one young lady identify as transgender, and the next thing you know, 6 or 7 young ladies in that same school are now identifying as transgender.
Children taught at age 5, they can create their gender identity, and it's being celebrated.
Schools are lining up to push the transgender agenda on kids and cut parents out of the equation.
Every cell of their body that has a nucleus is male or female.
We've now seen parents losing custody of their children if they don't go along with this.
We've all been created XY or XX, so that means there's only 2 genders. And so really the battle is against the creator.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
The most powerful organs of the state are not merely corrupt, but that they've been weaponized.
We are now all rooting for his success.
That's not what happened.
It was a complete ambush.
I thought it's early enough. Let's just send a couple guys over.
And the audience was, ha 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 ha. How funny to set up an innocent man.
It divided the country in ways that people can't imagine. It's inspired massive violence.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
I grew up poor, which is even worse than being poor.
We would have sandwiches with no meat.
My American dream entailed working hard and making $20,000 a year. But I surpassed that goal and became a corporate CEO.
We'll all be able to say, free at last, free at last.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Morning, glory, America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. We are at a dark place in American history. We are relying on the president of France to stop Russia from invading Ukraine. That's where we are. Macron is going off to see Putin to stop him from invading Ukraine. Germany has de facto left NATO. President Biden has been ineffective at best in his communications with Putin, and we are on the brink of war. In fact, yesterday, Jake Sullivan went on Fox News Sunday with Martha MacCallum, who's coming up a little bit later. I want to talk to her about that interview. And Jake said this, I don't know Jake Sullivan, but I call him Jake, said this about China.
Why not reopen the Keystone Pipeline?
Our view is that China is not in a position to compensate Russia for the economic losses that would come from our sanctions. That's the analysis that we and the Europeans share, and we believe the Russians and Chinese understand that as well. We also believe that when it comes down to it, ultimately, if Russia does choose to move forward, not only will it come at strategic cost to Russia, but if China is seen as having supported it, it will come at some cost to China as well in the eyes of the world, in the eyes of Europe, and in the eyes of other countries who are looking on now and sending a clear message that they would prefer to see diplomacy over war here.
Yeah, you know, I think it would be easier to say we will blow up both Nord Stream 1 and 2 if they invade Ukraine. That might actually work, but we didn't get that out of Jake Sullivan yesterday. We did get Ted Cruz on Fox with Maria Bartiromo, and Ted remains, the senator remains, one of the best interviews in America, like Chris Christie, talking about GoFundMe, collecting money for Canadian truckers, and then saying, no, we're going to give that to somebody else. Dave Yost, the Attorney General of Ohio, took about 5 minutes to say, I'll sue you. Because you cannot allow third parties to begin redirecting your charitable campaign, your charitable contribution. Fox went, Maria Bartiromo had Ted Cruz on yesterday, cut number three.
Well, listen, it is theft on the part of GoFundMe. Let me say the Canadian truckers are heroes. They are patriots, and they are marching for your freedom and for my freedom. They are those truck drivers that, God bless them, they're defending Canada, but they're defending America as well. That is courage on display, that the government doesn't have the right to force you to comply to their arbitrary mandates. And they're standing up for freedom. And of course, big government hates it and is trying to crush them. Of course, the corporate media hates it and is trying to silence them. And big tech, you look at what GoFundMe did. People gave $10 million to support the Freedom Convoy because they were so proud of the courage of these truck drivers. And the thieves in Silicon Valley decided, we don't like your politics. So A, we're going to take your money. And then B, we're going to give it to people we like. Listen, if anyone else did that, that is called theft. And so today, I sent a letter to the Federal Trade Commission asking that the FTC open an investigation into GoFundMe into whether they've committed...
Stop right there. That's so good. The administrative state, Federal Trade Commission, is supposed to be on the watch for fraud. And normally they're sending you, don't use this crib, don't use that car seat stuff. And that's good. That's important work. But they also are supposed to stop fraud. And GoFundMe violated every FTC reg in the world. Senator Cruz is a smart guy. You know, Senator Cruz, under traditional norms, would be considered the front runner in 2024 because he came in second in 2020. Now, there are a lot of people who are going to get up to the bar here if President Trump doesn't run. And if Chris Christie is right, there are going to be a lot of people at the bar anyway. But it's good to hear. I love having Senator Cruz clips. Dwayne won't give them to me very much. He wants me to work harder. Even though I spent yesterday talking all day long, so my voice is shot. As I said, I got together with our former pastor and spouse, Linda and Mark Roberts, with the Fetching Mr. Hewitt and I, and we just talked for hours because he's a brilliant guy, she's a brilliant lady, and we are old and dear friends. He's married two of my children, baptized a couple of my grandkids, pastor for 30 years. Smart. Visit the Fuller Theological Seminary's Dupree Center, and you'll get, sign up for his daily devotional. It's great. Or get third. He's now writing specifically for people in the third of life. It's great stuff. Also great stuff, Ron DeSantis, governor of Florida, the free state of Florida, went to the Fed SOC, that would be Federalist Society, for the benefit of the Blue Bubble Legacy Media and the Pittsburgh Steelers fans. Here's what he said, cut number four.
Big city mayors, and I'll tell you, and anchor some of these leftist TV hosts who constantly criticize Florida, mandate masks, lockdown, all this stuff. Then they end up on the beach somewhere in South Florida. I'll tell you, one of the things I'm proud, though, is like our Floridians, they give these people hell when they see them down here because they're proud of our freedom, and they know these people have been bad-mouthing. The cherry on the sundae was when you had over New Year's, you had AOC coming down, criticizing Florida, then comes down. So we decided to make kind of a little joke about it. So we created T-shirts that said Escape to Florida, the Lockdown Liberal Tour. And instead of having concert dates on the back, we had Governor Whitmer, March of 2021, AOC, and the dates they were all in Florida. And we sold more outside the state than we sold here, because people realize how hypocritical these people are.
I think that he's winning on the Free State of Florida message. We're going to have a heck of a primary. But I must tell you, after moderating two debates on Saturday, have microphone will travel. The key is I'm better at this than anybody else in America, and so I will go when I am asked, unless I have, can't be fair. I can't be fair in Missouri because I think Eric Greitens is a Chernobyl of a candidate. Radioactive and will destroy the Republican Party, and I've been a Republican my whole life. I got asked yesterday by my friend Mark what I thought about the Donald Trump administration. I said, you know, I've worked my whole life for the Supreme Court to have a 6-3 originalist majority, and now we're going to see. Because people forget, it's the Constitution first. Now, in your personal life, it's God first, family second, country third, or God, country, family. Depends on what your job is. But, and if you're in the military, it's going to be God, country, family. And they do that every day. But, conservatives forget. And legacy media has never wanted to understand that Donald Trump's domestic triumph is Operation Warp Speed. His international triumph is the Abraham Accords and reality about China. But his most enduring triumph is the United States Supreme Court 6-3. And if Dobbs overturns Roe and overturns Casey, and I expect that it will, you will have Donald Trump to thank for that, and Leader McConnell. You can't actually be pro-Trump and anti-McConnell or anti-Trump and pro-McConnell. I mean, you got to like them. They both did the most important thing they could do in their job in that role. Nominate and get confirmed 3 originalists. Should ask Christie about that, but I ran out of time. Joe Manchin, this is listener porn. Actually, I don't approve of porn, but I do know listener porn. Joe Manchin on State of the Union with Jake Tapper yesterday, cut number 5.
The Build Back Better, as it has been presented over, the last 7, 8, 9 months, mm-hmm. That bill no longer will exist, okay? Should there be parts of it? Do you want to talk about different things? I think the president said there might be certain parts and this and that. My biggest concern and my biggest opposition, it did not go through the process. Whether Lisa votes for it or not, being a Republican, she should have at least the opportunity to have input. It should have gone through the committee. These are major changes. It's going to change society as we know it.
Yeah.
And so those changes should be a hearing. It should be a markup. And then you're going to have a better product whether your friends on the other side vote for it or not. But they have to have input.
Joe Manchin endorsed Lisa Murkowski yesterday, who will win in Alaska, by the way. She will win. It's like Susan Collins in Maine. You can't beat her. Don't try. You're going to waste your money. Lisa Murkowski is a member of the Senate for life, as long as she wants to be a member of the Senate. And I endorse her, and I don't think we should waste a dime up there, because she's going to win. It's like Eric Greitens is going to lose in Missouri. And so I can't go moderate a debate in Alaska, nor would I actually think that investment of time wise. But I do think it's important for me to bring you Hugh Jackson, head coach of the Cleveland Browns for 3 long years. He finally gets around to Joe Rogan in this clip. Cut number 9.
You know, and speaking of racism in American society, I wanted to ask you, Coach, about Joe Rogan, who is now apologizing after these videos have surfaced of him using the N-word multiple times on his podcast. I'm just curious if you've heard about this. What are your thoughts on all of this? And do you think Joe Rogan should be able to stay on Spotify, where his podcast is carried on that platform?
No, it's terrible. It is no different than what's happening in society today. And obviously the National Football League is showing itself the same way. And it's just disappointing that, like I said, here in 2022, we're having these kind of conversations. I mean, we have people that are especially in the National Football League, and that's what I know more than anything, that are very deserving of opportunities. But for the whatever reason, the owners, the racism that's going on has been a problem. I just want the NFL and team owners to just be held to the same standards that they print in their constitution and bylaws, the integrity of the game documents and all other documents that they claim the foundation of the shield. I just like for people to be held accountable for what they say they do. And if they don't do it, right's right and wrong's wrong. And I think we'll find out more about what's really going on in the National Football League.
You know, I play Hugh Jackson for McNeil, the blogger extraordinaire in Cleveland. That was for you, McNeil. This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with a clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with two senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, two former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet, with 3 years to go, is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
What the Supreme Court has said is you have to have a compelling state interest, and the compelling state interest that the Supreme Court found was the benefits that flow from having a diverse student body, whatever those benefits may be. But you have to have a diverse student body to get these certain benefits, okay? So that justifies this kind of racial alchemy in terms of admissions. Here's the problem. Increasingly at schools, you have, regardless of how supposedly integrated they are, you're getting more and more racial separatism, separate classes, separate dormitories, separate graduations. There's more and more of that going on. And one of the basic reasons for that is because of mismatch, because of the serious mismatch in academic qualifications between Asians, Latinos, Blacks, and whites.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
You want to know what's even crazier and funnier in a sick way? There's a security guard right there. The shoplifter, the looter, walks right by the security guard who isn't doing anything. He's got a jacket on with the big security on the back of his coat, and he stands there and watches the guy. The guy literally brushes right by the security guard. The security guard, what are they paying the security guard for? Just to stand there? Why don't we just put mannequins up in stores in New York? I may never go back. I swear, I may never go back. New York is turning into a hellhole, and Democrats are watching it. They're letting it happen. I can't wait to get Joe Borelli's take on all of this insanity.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
You called your son. You personally promised him you would be here.
Lucas, I don't know how to help you.
Your daddy loves you. You gotta know it, pal.
Do you feel the love?
Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work. If you believe.
What reason does he have to care about some guy who's supposed to be his dad, but he's never around?
I can't do it. I can't. I'm not ready for this, man.
I'm done with you.
We ought deserve a second chance. Right, Ethan?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt from the West Coast this morning, live. I've got to tell you, when the Financial Times runs a headline, bond market signals room for Fed to raise rates without stalling economy. What does that mean? That means if you're going to buy a home, you had better hurry up and call andrewandtodd.com, a great sponsor of this show, with Sierra Pacific, 888-888-1172. Do not wait until the end of the day. Call them now. 888-888-1172. The 10-year treasury is up to 1.9 something. The market report being brought to you by Andrew and Todd tells us that on Friday, the Dow went down 21 points. That's a, meh. S&P went up 23. That's meh. The NASDAQ went up 219. That's pretty good. Amazon went up 13.5%, and I expect it will continue to do so all week. I'm not a prophet nor the son of a prophet. I'm an investor in Amazon, but I don't know that for sure. It could go down. I don't understand the market. I am a political and public policy analyst and a lawyer. I don't tell people what to buy in stocks. I know one thing, though. Whether or not Amazon goes up or down or gold goes up or down, I know that interest rates are going up. All right, that's the... I am certain the interest rates are going to go up. So if you're going to buy a house or you're going to refinance a house, you're losing money every day you wait. Go to andrewandtodd.com. Speaking about losing money, I have a moral quandary here. I am a sports junkie and for Cleveland sports. And the Athletic Cleveland is almost as good as cleveland.com and better than Akron Beacon Journal, though they've got Nate Ulrich and a few people at the Journal that are good. And I just consume Cleveland sports stuff. Like the Cavs made a great trade last night. I mean, we're the Cavaliers are going to be go deep in the playoffs, I think. It's just incredible. The Cavaliers, that's true. So I got the notice yesterday, the notice that isn't a notice, February 6th at 4:56 p.m. to me. Hi, Hugh. Thanks for being a subscriber to The Athletic. We wanted to let you know we've increased the price of an annual subscription to The Athletic by $1 a month. On March 8th, 2022, your annual subscription will renew at $71.99. And it goes on to tell me how wonderful The Athletic is. They do not include a link where I can cancel The Athletic, which I believe if you're going to be the FTC, you ought to make renewal notices mandatory and you ought to make it easy to say no thanks. Here's my moral dilemma. The Athletic, like Wordle, was brought by the New York Times. The New York Times is the extension of the Democratic National Committee. Now, there are some great reporters there who are not. They are very good reporters. Peter comes on the show, and Mike comes on the show, and I like New York Times reporters. But it's a left-wing operation that is the wokest in the world. The Post is center-left, but it's not left-wing. New York Times is left-wing. So they bought The Athletic, and they bought Wordle. So the question is, do I give them $71.99? And if I don't want to, should it be this hard to figure out? They say to us, our updating prices reflect the growth in value that a subscription to The Athletic provides. You can review and manage your subscription anytime on The Athletic in your account settings. Now, if you tell this to an old person, most old people, and by that I mean over 75, not 65. I'm a young 65. 65 is the new 90. So anyway, if you tell that to an older person, they're not going to have any idea how to cancel that subscription. None at all. And they won't even know what that means, and it's doubtful that they'll have read their email. I think that the Congress ought to get together on opting in for subscription renewals. I think. I really do think. And if there's a commercial speech issue here, there's a free speech issue here. The Athletic isn't defrauding me because they're kind of telling me that I can get out, but they're not really telling me to get out, right? Does anyone think that's actually a legit notice? I don't care about 95% of what The Athletic put. They're an ESPN, right? They got 95% of sports covered. I only care about the Cleveland silo, and I've got to go see if they'll give me a break because, frankly, Cleveland.com is a better buy. And $72 ain't chump change. That's a lot of money for something that I only use to read about the Browns and the Guardians and the Cavs and the Ohio State University Buckeyes, which they don't do a very good job. And it's now owned by the New York Times. I am conflicted. I am deeply conflicted. Martha MacCallum joins me. I had a great interview yesterday with Jake Sullivan. I want to talk to her about that because Martha's really good. Don't go anywhere, America. It's the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show brought to you by Sierra Pacific Mortgage. For more info, call 888-888-1172.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
It seems like the Democrats tried their best to try to eliminate the filibuster, and it failed. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, thankfully, it did fail. Republicans stood united against that, as we have been from the very beginning, and Kyrsten Sinema and Joe Manchin also stood with us in preserving the rules and the customs of the Senate. These rules and customs go back more than 200 years, Charlie. They are directly downstream from why our founders created a Senate in the first place, to provide the sober second thought against radical sweeping change to our country. It's pretty amazing that 48 out of 50 Democrats were willing to blow up the filibuster. They were willing to break the rules to change the rules. And Charlie, that would have just been the first step towards redistributing political power in this country. The Democrats' next stop probably would have been to make Washington, D.C. a state, our federal city that is by far the most liberal jurisdiction in America. So the Democrats could get two more Democratic senators in perpetuity. The next stop would have been to pack our federal courts to include the Supreme Court, to stop the courts from overturning any of these unconstitutional actions. This entire effort, Charlie, was not about just altering this or that public policy. It was about forever changing the structure of political power in our country. You sometimes heard the argument that, well, the Democrats shouldn't do this because the shoe was on their other foot. Their entire goal was to make sure, Charlie, the shoe would never be on the other foot. So it was a critical day in the history of our country and the history of the Senate as an institution. And I'm glad we stopped these radicals. That's why we have to turn them out of power in November.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
This really is a Leninist strategy. Lenin's old saying that the capitalists will sell us the rope by which we will hang them is what China's doing. The Soviets couldn't do it for a couple reasons. Number one, they didn't have the money. They didn't have a whole lot of rubles to throw around, and people in the West didn't want them. But number two, there was a lot bigger sense of social cohesion during the Cold War. The notion, if you're a corporate executive during the Cold War, that you would be playing footsies with the Kremlin was outrageous. And yet in the case of China, the human rights situation, the challenge to American national security, is every bit as great. I would argue perhaps even greater than it was in the Cold War era. But Wall Street, Silicon Valley, they are all happy to not only do deals with them, but do deals with them that benefit the Chinese military and intelligence state. And they don't seem to particularly care that they do.
Well, there was stigma in helping the Soviets. There's no stigma in helping the Chinese communists.
That's right. And I think that, you know, part of that is there's been this naivete for decades that if we just gave China money, if we gave them access to our technology, they were going to buy our blue jeans, they were going to watch some of our movies, they would become just like us. What's really happened, when you look at issues like censorship by big tech in the United States, when you look at some of the other things that are going on, it's not that China's become more like us. We've actually become more like China. And that experiment has to fade away. And the problem is, not only were our elites wrong in their prescription of that policy, but that policy made them rich. And they do not want to now give up those relationships with Beijing because it means the money's going to stop flowing.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Welcome back, America, live from the West Coast this morning. I'm Hugh Hewitt. If you do not have Martha MacCallum on your record every day at 3 p.m. on the Fox News channel, you're missing something. She also hosted Fox News Sunday yesterday, and I'm glad she's here to talk about that. Good morning, Martha. Welcome back.
Good morning, Hugh. Great to be with you.
Can I embarrass you a little bit? My buddy O'Brien, Robert O'Brien, has been my friend for 15 years, very close friend, former law partner.
Yeah.
Tells me you're one of the four people he'll talk to on television at any time because you're actually smart and prepared. That's a big compliment.
Well, that doesn't embarrass me. That makes me feel great. He's a wonderful guest, and obviously you are a wonderful commentator and writer, and I've followed your work all these years as well. So I'm in good company.
So let me talk about Jake Sullivan yesterday, because you did a very good, very crisp interview with the National Security Advisor, and you interview the other National Security Advisor often. How do those two compare, Martha MacCallum, as an interview?
Well, obviously they're very different people with very different perspectives on how to negotiate a stronger position for the United States in the world. And Jake Sullivan says, you know, that's his goal. He says, big picture, when you look at things, my job is to make sure that the United States and our allies come out stronger from all of this in the end, and that Russia and their allies come out weaker in all of this. And I'm not sure that that's the path that we're taking here. And when you look back to when Robert O'Brien was the National Security Advisor, you had a very different equation, which was focused on making sure that we were strong in energy and other aspects of the economy that gave us some leverage in the global picture that allowed us to have strengths that would make it, that would decrease, frankly, Putin's leverage. When you look at things like the Keystone XL pipeline and allowing federal leases for natural gas on American land, all of those things really helped to give us energy independence, which was a huge, huge advantage. I mean, that alone, I think, shifted the geopolitical picture.
Absolutely, it did.
In a way that is really, very difficult to overestimate.
You give Putin $100 a barrel gas, oil, he's got twice the defense budget.
Yeah, and right now we're scrambling to find ways to help, Europe to deal with an energy shortage if this thing goes to the point where Putin can't supply them anymore. And that's not a great equation. That's not where you want to be.
So now I want to go a bit broader, Martha. You and Brett and Dana and Bill and John, there are a bunch of hard news people over at Fox News. When Chris, I know you're a friend, I'm not asking you to criticize Chris or comment on Chris. I never comment on anyone I've ever worked with in the media, ever. Whether they're left, right, center, I don't. But when Chris left Fox News Sunday It had 1,100,000 viewers on the last Sunday. CBS Face the Nation had 3 million. ABC just under 3 million. Meet the Press, 2.6. Fox, 1.1. I think Fox is going to win the Sunday show. Do you?
I do. Chris did a fantastic job. I loved working with him over all those years on election coverage, and he's super smart, as everyone knows. I do think we can win that slot. We've won every other slot. So certainly I think that we can put our heads together and be very formidable in that space. And, you know, one of the things that it takes is I do think that on Sunday people like to see a good sort of respectful back and forth. And they want to see questions that will provoke some real answers out of the guests. But you also have to have a forum where you're going to get those people to the table to talk. And that's hard in today's world on all sides of the aisle. So I think that's the goal for that Sunday show. And I think if that can be achieved, I think it'll be blockbuster.
And I want to underscore, Jake Sullivan went on to talk to you yesterday. So he trusts you. When Brett was hosting in December, Joe Manchin went on to talk to him. Democrats trust Fox News Sunday. They will come on. I am not certain that the rest of the networks have not lost the trust of the American people in terms of their slant. Do you hear that from people, Martha?
I think there's a general frustration across the board with the fact that everything has become so siloed and that there isn't more sort of courageous back and forth. And I really appreciated Jake Sullivan coming on yesterday because these are really important issues that we need to talk about. And I think there has to be a fair place where those kind of discussions can happen, where it's not hitting below the belt and gotcha. But the questions are there that need to be answered. So, you know, we pushed him a bit on the energy issue and the big picture of what's going on in Ukraine and whether or not we should be there in the first place. So I really appreciate it. I hope he'll come on my 3 o'clock show as well.
It's crucial for national security people to go on all networks, and when the host is prepared, like Martha is, to let them ask you tough questions. Because today we've got Macron negotiating with Putin, which I think is a defeat of the United States in and of itself, Martha. Do you understand what I'm saying when I make that point?
I absolutely understand what you're saying there, yes.
What did you get from Jake? Does he evidence confidence in our ability to be heard on the world stage?
You know, I think that President Biden spoke with President Putin yesterday, as I understand it, from the White House. He has definitely taken a different posture on this. And I think the language that Macron is using is pretty interesting. He's very clear that he wants to change the dynamic. He wants the EU to be the person who is on the front line negotiating what's going on in Europe. Maybe that's the way it should be. But he's making no bones about how he sees his position in the world. He's got an election coming up in April. And I think that it would be naive to not look at what's going on right now and see that powers in the world are shifting and attempting to shift power away from the United States. And that's something that we just need to look at squarely and be aware of and ask ourselves whether or not we're okay with that.
Yeah, the Putin-Xi picture over the weekend should just be an electric jolt. When you see that picture, what do you think, Martha MacCallum?
Well, I think that Putin is aligning himself in a position. It's, you know, those are our biggest adversaries in the world. So when they get together, it reminds me of Germany and Japan, frankly. It reminds me of where we've been before. And I think if you don't learn the lessons of history, you will be burned by them. I think Putin is concerned about sanctions, and I think he hopes that China can give him some relief from those. Obviously, China is a much bigger, more powerful global actor than Russia is. And I think there's probably been a little too much emphasis on Russia in many ways. But, you know, this is a question that we have tried. You know, you think about the Russia reset. There's been attempts to sort of make sure that this doesn't happen, but it's happening now, and we have to face that reality.
I agree. And playing the part of Italy in this recasting of 1939 is Iran. Did That's Jake right. indicate anything? They have a crazy off-the-record point of view going around, which is if we don't go back to the JCPOA, it's a win. I don't understand what they're doing on Iran. Do you?
Well, they have now given them some sanctions relief. And I think that it's the same sort of thing that we've seen in other areas where they believe that if you sort of give them something and you're nice to them and make their world a little bit more comfortable, that they'll come around. And that has not been the case with Iran, and they're getting closer, not further away from having a nuclear weapon. So we're in a very tough spot with that triumvirate forming. And it's, and you know, for the larger picture, it's because of what they stand for. You know, these are communist nations who believe very different things than we believe. And that's very important, you know, that force for good. I mean,
they're all totalitarians. Yeah, you know, two are communists. Well, so, they're actually only China has it anymore, but they're all totalitarians. I think that's what you meant to say. And so my question is, when you sit down with Jake and you have a limited amount of time, Jake Sullivan or Robert O'Brien, you have 8 minutes, 9 minutes. It's a long bit of Sunday turf. How do you prepare for that?
You know, I started with just a broad scope of questions, a lot of focus on Afghanistan, on Ukraine, rather, a little bit of Afghanistan, a little bit of Iran at the end. You never have the amount of time that you want to have to get to them. And all of these people tend to have very long answers. So you kind of want to find that pace so that you can get as much in as you can. And I rewrite my questions, you know, 3-4 times before you sort of settle on, okay, this is the order that I want to ask them in, and this is how this should go. And it's what we love to do, really. I mean, it's almost like when you're doing a debate or you're doing a town hall, and you get these moments where you can really talk to people in power, and you want to make it as precise as you can.
Yeah, I loved it. I did 2 debates in Arizona for their Senate and GOP governor candidates on the weekend. I love doing debates. Now, let me ask you quickly, the Olympics ratings. Now, I don't want to slag my old friends at NBC. The decision to televise those were made arguably when China wasn't totalitarian and engaged in genocide and crushing Hong Kong. But they're stuck with them, and the ratings are awful. Why do you think that is?
Well, they're sort of in a rock and a hard place, because I think the promotion, and even on the American companies, you know, Coca-Cola used to put, you know, Olympic rings on the side of every single Coke can in America because they've sponsored the Olympics forever. It's almost like they want to pretend like it's not happening, but they have to embrace it. So they're in a very difficult position. I also think that this never should have happened. You know, it's become extremely commercial. The IOC makes a ton of money on this arrangement. And I think that's something that has seeped into the American understanding of the Olympics. So when I was a kid, I was glued to the Olympics for 2 straight weeks. I couldn't wait to watch it from opening ceremony to closing ceremony. Plus, they were amateur athletes. You know, now you've got, I thought, well, wouldn't it be amazing if you had sort of a recreation of 1980 with the U.S. and Soviet hockey teams playing each other? But something like a third or a half of the Chinese hockey team was born in the United States or North America. So I think it makes it really hard for people to sort of cheer on their teams the way that they did in the past.
Yeah, you're way too young to remember 72, but I watched hours of a frozen camera on the Israeli athletes taken hostage by the, and I watched every other minute of the game. I just think the American public are rejecting the regime in China overwhelmingly. A last question, and this is a off the top of my head. I asked the candidates for Arizona governor GOP nomination if they had received the booster. I did so because President Trump said people should answer that question, and they're all running in the Trump lane. None of them would answer that question. Martha, do you think it's a good question for people? Have you received the booster?
You know, I guess it is. I think I feel that I feel like it's a personal answer. I have no problem saying that I've got 2 vaccines, and then I got a booster, and then I got COVID after that. So I feel pretty inoculated at the moment. But I do, I guess I'm a little bit, I feel like it's okay for people to say, you know what, that's my personal health decision, and I don't want to answer it. But I think it's a great question to ask.
Yeah, you know what's interesting?
It reveals, how people feel about the whole question, which I
that's
think
it.
Is a brilliant question.
That's it. It just, and they all declined, and they said, and I would never ask a private sector person, I wouldn't ask anyone not seeking office that question, because it's their own damn business. But with President Trump out there saying, answer the question, and 4 would-be conservative Trumpists running in Arizona, I just thought it was obvious to me. But I appreciate your perspective on that. It's just going to come up again and again. Martha MacCallum, Fox News Sunday yesterday. Great show this afternoon at 3 p.m. in the East. Nap time for you in the West, but nevertheless. Martha, be well. Thank you for joining me.
You be well, too. Thank you for having me, Hugh.
All right. I just think Martha, Brett, John, Bill, Dana, Fox News owns the news. Fox News owns the real news. I mean, they got opinion people, too. Tucker, I'm asleep by the time Tucker's on. Sean, I've been dead to the world for a couple hours. But I am certain that if you watch Fox, you'll see relieffactor.com. I think they've got Seb and Larry. I don't do TV ads. I tell people about my sponsors on the radio, because otherwise I wouldn't be on the radio. I'm very proud to take relieffactor.com, but I don't do TV ads. And even though I take Relief Factor every day, you've seen the bag with Seb and Larry, and it's good for you to try it. At least try it. $19.95. My argument to everyone out there is a three-week supply of Icarian Curcumin Resveratrol Omega pills cannot hurt you, and they may very well help you. Why wouldn't you spend $20 to try that? I really just would like to know why you wouldn't do that. Hotline Josh is next, America. Stay tuned. Hey, Dwayne, have you got Chris Christie posted yet? Apparently not. Don't go anywhere, America.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com. Streaming on Salem Now.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys. Never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery.
He said, listen, I gotta give these niggas enough. Not too much, but enough that I have them voting Democrat for the next 200 years.
The race grievance industry would have you believe that blacks get up and think about nothing else except race.
If I tell you this is racist, yeah, I'm gonna get you emotional.
There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd, a bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, 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 racist. Everything's racist.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
When you had the president in Atlanta saying to the crowd there that, you know, he didn't march in the shoes of the students that are marching today, but that he marched in the civil rights movement, and he remembers the first time he got arrested, when he never marched in any civil rights movement and has never been arrested.
I mean, can we even believe this? That he routinely says things that everyone knows are made up. Nobody calls him on it. Look, this is why you do your program, I do my program. We need to do our best to get the truth out. And we have to be clear. The president, he's plumb loco. I don't know what is going on. I guess I would say this. I'll bet that within his administration, there is very nasty fighting because they see what we see. I'm sure Kamala Harris despises the Biden gang, and the Biden gang despises her. They have to keep that quiet. But it's really something that I think they're going to consume their own.
The Democratic Party knows that they're in trouble. When you say that their staff sees what's going on and we all see it, we got to remember one other thing. Vladimir Putin, Premier Xi, the leader of North Korea, the leader of Iran, these people all see it too.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, joined by Josh Kraushaar, Hotline Josh on Twitter from National Journal. Good morning, Josh. Good Monday to you.
Good morning, Hugh.
What do you know about Senator Lujan's medical condition?
You know, I don't know anything that's not already been reported, that
he had a stroke. Thankfully, he seems to be on the mend. He's going to be out of Washington for at least 4 to 6 weeks. It sounds like he's. I remember when Senator Kirk of Illinois many years ago had a serious stroke and he was, incapacitated for quite some time. It doesn't sound like Senator Lujan's condition is quite as serious, but we don't know a whole lot more other than what
we don't know. And I think actually I talked about this with Jake Sherman yesterday. Senator Lujan is the Senate, a 50-50 Senate. If you lose a Democrat, Mitch McConnell should be running the floor. And if he's not going to be back, now they organized the Senate at the beginning, and I don't think Leader McConnell is going to, stage a coup. But I'm really curious. Do you think the legacy media owes the country some idea of when he's going to be back?
Yeah, I mean, well, look, they've said what they've said. I've known Senator Lujan for quite some time. He was headed the House Campaign Committee. He's one of the youngest senators. I mean, this was really surprising news because he is one of the youngest senators in the body.
As was Mark Kirk. I mean, Mark Kirk was young and healthy. A stroke is a bad thing. My prayers are with him, but we should know.
Yeah, I mean, look, they said, the office said, they expected about a month or two for him to be out of commission. But look, this has, even more notably, it has significant consequences on the Supreme Court strategy for the Biden administration. If they don't have a 50th vote by the time Biden makes his pick and the hearings are going to be held, that's going to, it should affect his calculations and his thinking of whether he needs to get at least a couple of Republicans on board for his selection.
Well, one of the things I think is obvious is that they can say to Senator Lujan, resign, we'll appoint a caretaker. When you're ready, that caretaker will resign and you can go back. Isn't that the obvious solution?
Well, look, if it's serious, if that timeline that the office outlined is too optimistic, then maybe the more extreme measures are necessary. But I from everything I've heard, there doesn't seem to be a sense of panic. It's just a matter of kind of waiting this out and waiting him to get back into health so he can return to Washington.
Well, I would like legacy media to tell us about this. Now, about Justice Brown Jackson, Judge Brown Jackson of the D.C. Circuit. Washington Free Beacon this morning does a deep dive into something I did not know. She represented Gitmo detainees and did so vigorously. Now, I am a big believer that everyone prosecuted by the United States, whether in the military courts, special courts, or civilian courts, prosecuted state level, you're entitled to counsel. That's a constitutional right. I got no problem with people defending people. But who you choose to represent and how you do it become issues. Do you expect Republicans will drill down on this and thus replay the collapse of Afghanistan every day during her hearings? And if so, do you expect Biden to steer away from her? Because he can't want that, right? He can't want the Afghanistan question to dominate the confirmation hearings.
Yeah, I mean, look, I saw a little bit of the Free Beacon story. I think your point is right that, look, everyone deserves legal counsel. And I don't think, this has anything to do with her politics. I think it has to do with her profession. And that probably isn't going to be held against her in a hearing. Now, I think the politics more broadly is that she is considered, of the three leading names mentioned, she's considered among the progressives seem to like her the most. I think the legal experts are going to pore over her record. I'm not sure if her representation is going to mean a whole lot. But one of the other judges, Michelle Child, has been attacked from the left because she represented corporations. That she her job entailed her to represent, big business. And even though, I don't know what her politics are or her judicial philosophy is, that's just part of her background and her resume. So, I don't know how much to weigh the fact that she represented some of these Gitmo folks, and I don't really know if that's going to have a huge impact on.
Josh, you and I can tell everyone all day long that everyone gets the right to counsel, and Americans will not like that she did it. And more importantly, what she did in the course of it will become I just think it's a red flag, sort of like Brett Kavanaugh got a red flag on his decision tree from Mitch McConnell to Trump that they went around anyway. Got to close by asking you, though, about the ratings for the Olympics. They're horrible, Josh. What does that tell you?
That many Americans don't want to watch an Olympics being conducted in a state with such human rights abuses as China. And I saw that Mike Tirico is leaving China early. I don't know why, but he was, thankfully condemning the human rights record of the Chinese. So, this is you can't gloss over China's human rights record. And I think, Americans are tuning out because it's just hard to celebrate when you have such atrocities taking place in the country.
Have you watched a minute of it?
Very little. A few minutes over the weekend, but not much at all.
No, I haven't seen a minute of it. Refuse. They're engaged in the systematic destruction of two cultures, Tibet and Uyghur, and the suppression of free Hong Kong, and I won't have anything to do with it, and I think NBC and sponsors made a huge mistake. Josh Kraushaar, National Journal, follow him at Hotline. Josh, you should watch those Arizona debates I did on Saturday. Oh, has the Republican Party got some fault lines in it. I'll be back, America, tomorrow. Thank you, Adam. Thank you, Dwayne. Thank you, Ben. Ben, I need to talk to you after the show. Don't run away. And America, come back tomorrow, because there's always news, and I always give you the breaking news right here on the Hugh Hewitt Show.